This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good morning and welcome to another magical Safari Live adventure, because this is Safari Live.
Ready? Standing by.
You are live, you are live.
And a very good morning and welcome to all of you on our Sunrise Safari. My name is Jamie, the gentleman behind the camera is Viam, and we have exciting things in store for you. Sorry, there's quite a nice sunrise, actually. So while we have a look at the beautiful sun coming over the horizon here in the African bush, if this is your first time experience on our live safari, we are coming to you from Juma, Arethusa and Cheetah Plains Game Reserves in the Sabi Sand in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. And we have so many wonderful things in store for you. What a beautiful morning. Tawny eagle calling, stopping to take in the sounds of the bush for a moment. A very warm thank you to Chris and many others who sent through the updates about what was happening on the Juma Dam camera last night whilst we were safely tucked away in our beds. Apparently, the youngest Nkuhuma lioness, so a lioness that we see been mating with one of the Birmingham boys around 4 o'clock this morning. We're going to try where she's gone. Tracks of the rest of the pride going in that general direction. I've called in Herbie. Sorry about that, everybody. You disappeared off your screen for a second. As you know, there's some, every now and again, bringing live safari from the middle of the African bush does come with its pros and cons and difficulties and easy things. Easy things, of course, is being able to enjoy the beautiful environment that we were in. Difficult, well, sometimes we have what are known as the attack of the gremlins. Now, just quickly, so that for our new viewers, you know how this all works. Questions at wildearth.tv. Sorry, again, apologies. We seem to be going through some strange signal dips, which is odd because we shouldn't be on Weaver's Nest. This should be fine. This is a mystery to me. Aha. Okie dokie. Alright, we seem to be back up and running. So last night at the on the Sunset Safari, and treated to an amazing experience with Brent on Arethusa with the Tsalala Pride, a pride of lions that we hardly ever get to see, and a male leopard that we hardly ever get to see and that I have never seen ever, so that's what I'm really excited about this morning, the Anderson male, rumoured to be the biggest leopard in the Sabi Sand, definitely the biggest leopard in the northern Sabi Sand. Now that's something really exciting we can look forward to. We're not going there straight away. We'll let the other guides go and take their turn, the ones that are, whose property he is on. And then we shall make our way across there a little bit later this morning. Since he does have a massive warthog kill up in a tree, I watched the slow motion footage of him pulling that warthog into the tree. It was an unbelievable display of power. Truly phenomenal. To just watch him throw it over his shoulder and climb up the marula tree. See his muscles bunching. Truly spectacular. But when we finished off our sunset safari, we were with Karula and her one little cub. She'd been frantically calling, but she was so full of her impala kill and so warm that she wasn't really getting up and moving around calling for her cubs. She was just lying there going, rah, rah, as female leopards do. And her little cubs, behaving like recalcitrant teenagers, refused to come out for the longest time. So it was almost dark when one did arrive, and we had to leave the sighting. So what we're going to do now is just go and investigate her Dacre kill that she sort of not forgot about, but she sort of passed up in favor of the impala kill she made later. Let's go and see if she's remembered, if it's there, and managed to get collected from the ground where it was dropped onto. While we head across there, it's not just us out and about this morning. Steph is out on foot, which I'm sure you'll find very, very exciting. Let's head across to him so that he can say good morning.
Good morning, good morning. Yes, and welcome to the Bushwalk. It is myself, Steph indeed, and Jandre is on camera today. And we are just about to cross over quarantine and follow up on some lion noises that we heard early this morning. They have started to call south and east of where we are at the moment, and they've moved in the slow arc all the way from Galago Pan last night at the close of safari to around about 3:30, 4 o'clock this morning. It was the last time I heard them roar, at least. And they are now, it seems, in this area that is just in front of us here, around the Rebecca's Road, around Zoe's Road, around Balanites. And there's a good chance, Herbie seems to think, that there's a good chance that they're moving off towards Impala Plains. It would be quite rare for them to go to Impala Plains. I mean, I can't remember when the last time they were at Impala Plains, in actual fact. I see Jandre busy nodding his head over there, saying he agrees with that particular statement. So who knows what's happening, you know? With the flush in the grass that we've had over here, we've had this influx of herbivores. And you know, it's atypical to what's been happening around us. South in the Sabi Sands, there hasn't been any rain, the grass hasn't even flushed there. And I know from Hoedspruit, where I was over the weekend, not a single blade of green grass to be seen anywhere. In between us and Hoedspruit, it rained a little bit. Northern Manyeleti, in the Timbavati a little bit. And there we have a bit of grass, but nothing that's going to be detracting or pulling the animals from here, in that direction at least. So I'm not expecting lions to move far from water, is I think the point that I want to try and make. And I'm expecting them to sort of be within a mile or so of the water, the permanent water that's left. So the permanent water that we have at Vuyatela and the permanent water that we have at Galago, with a few pans and muddy wallows that are interspersed sort of and dotted around the bush here. But what a fantastic morning. The sun rose a bright red ball, around about 72 degrees Fahrenheit, at least about 22 degrees centigrade at sunrise this morning, which is usually, for me at least, the coldest time of the day. And generally what happens when you have a red ball arise up over the horizon, it heralds a weather change. So I don't remember seeing the weather forecasts at least predict anything until the end of next week. But you know, we get influenced quite heavily here by the Indian Ocean and Mozambican weather patterns rather than South African weather patterns, especially over spring and summertime. And I think that that's probably what's happening here. We're getting some type of weather system coming in from the sea, which is all good. It adds a nice spice to things. All right. Ah, have a look over there. That is probably about 400 or 500 yards from us. At the moment, on the other side of the valley, we have a herd of elephant. Now that is such a lovely sighting this time of the morning. We are, of course, on foot. We are unescorted. It's just three of us, made up of myself, Jandre, and Herb. Oh, we've got elephant in a massive arc around us. Basically, from here all the way to there, I've just heard an elephant give this rumble. So if there are lions in the area, these elephants will definitely chase them away. So elephant and lion have this understanding here. Lion get out of the way and elephant do what they want, I think is basically what the rule of thumb is. But with young calves in a herd, elephant get quite aggressive with lion here. And I think it's because the bush is so thick, and offers lions a nice hiding place. And obviously, lions are capable of killing elephant. They don't usually kill elephant here. I think in all the years I've been guiding, I've only heard of elephant being taken down by male lion coalitions. I haven't heard of prides of lion here taking down elephant at all, in actual fact. But nevertheless, I do see elephant chasing lion often. And lions generally get out of the way. They don't run panicky into the bush. They sort of just walk around and go back to the shade that they were lying in most of the times anyway. Now, what to do with elephant that are in such a big arc in front of us? Obviously, wind direction is key. Now, you have seen me a couple of times with elephant on foot. Sometimes we're far away, sometimes we're close by, but always our reaction is governed by the wind direction. Now, in our favor, so that's a good thing. So that's like rule number one when we're approaching elephant. You want to try and make sure that the wind is always gusting away from them and not from you to them. And in this particular instance, the wind is gusting up the valley and should give us a nice safe area to approach where you're looking at the moment. I know that area pretty well, and there is a distinct lack of termite mounds, noticeably high termite mounds at least anyway, in that area, which makes approaching them fairly dangerous. I'm just scanning them now to see exactly how many elephant we're dealing with here. So next to the little ash bag that I carry, the binoculars are a tool of the trade, something very important to have. I'm noticing, at least anyway, the bush in front of us looks clear. Looks like these elephants are sort of going towards Balanites Road. All right, now it looks pretty clear for us. I think let's chance crossing the drainage line here in front. Of course, we need to keep an eye open for these guys. Bumping into elephants and stragglers, young males, old males, females with baby calves, always dangerous, you know. Now, Jason, good morning, Jason. You've asked me what's the scariest moment I've ever had in the bush. Jason, to be quite honest, I'm quite a nervous character, actually. I've had many scary moments in the bush. But I suppose the one that comes to mind, the most recent one that comes to mind anyway, is one that happened with us on a walk just last week. We were walking along a drainage line, the same drainage line that feeds the Mulwati and comes down Gari Kat line. But we were in the thick block on the other side of the drainage line. I was with Jandre and we were with Rexon, and we came around a bush, and literally in front of us, walking towards us, and no more than 20 or 30 yards away, was a herd of elephant, of about 10 or 15 elephant. And we had a termite mound behind us, which we retreated to, which covered our shape a little bit. But the herd was around us, and when I mean around us, in an arc probably this wide in this direction. And that made it very difficult for us to stay in that particular position, because we would have been surrounded by elephant. And by the time they realized that we were there, we would have been way too close to females with a bunch of calves. And so what I decided to do, which is the right thing to do with elephant, is create distance between the older females with their calves as quickly as you can. And although we walked directly towards some young male elephant at the time, to get to a termite mound behind them, it was of the two choices that we had, either stay or move, it was the safest choice we had. So we basically walked straight at two young male elephant, who didn't actually see us in the end, to be quite honest, which was quite fascinating. They were busy feeding in the grass, didn't even notice us walking probably less than 10 yards away from them. And we walked up onto a termite mound, and these elephant literally walked to within 5 yards of us, walked around the termite mound, didn't even know we were there, and left without them knowing we were there. Just one elephant, I think, caught scent of us as we passed him, put up his head and gave a little bit of a, "Ooh, there's a human here somewhere close by," and then ended up walking back to his mother's. They stayed in the area. They didn't even know we were there, which is exactly how we like to do things out here. So I'd say that in recent times, that was probably the scariest thing that's happened to me. All right, now we are going to send you back over to Jamie, who is on search for Karula this morning, so that she can give you an update.
So, searching for Karula, and we've come across an interesting sight. Sorry, these shoes collect sand quite easily. I've just been going for a walk through this drainage system, or this river system, to where Karula had her dacre kill. What's interesting about it is that it's back in the what's left of it is back in the tree. And I've just been for a walk, distracted by a vulture flying overhead. I've just been for a little bit of a walk and I can't see any sign of her, just fresh tracks moving out of this river system. So I'll show you what's left of her dacre kill. Still lots of sand in my shoes. Looks like it's just two dangling legs, and it still smells a little odd around here, but that makes sense since that dacre carcass was left for a day and a half before she started feeding on it. I think she did come through last night, and I think between the three of them, they actually finished that entire dacre off. But that means with a belly full of impala and a belly full of dacre, I don't think she's going to be going terribly far. There it is, that's, I think, all that is left. Dangling from the tree. Two little dacre legs. And that's that. Always a macabre sight. Okay. Oh, there's more there. So where is she? Has she gone to go and fetch the cubs, maybe? That's very confusing. I thought I saw more initially when I was walking. And I came back to the car. Well, this is confusing. She wouldn't leave it. She wouldn't have abandoned that. Leopards are not fussy about what they eat, and the fact that it's a little bit rotten would not have been a deterrent at all for our Queen Karula or any leopard. They don't mind rotting food. They don't mind rotting meat. So it's not that she's abandoned it. She's clearly gone to the trouble of putting it back in the tree. But where's she gone? I don't quite understand. I would have expected her to be somewhere at the base, but I've just walked around here and she's not here. I can guarantee I would have seen her because she would have moved with me walking in that particular spot. Karula's very, very relaxed on foot, but there's only so relaxed a cat can be. Maybe she's gone for a drink. That doesn't make much sense either. Let's follow her tracks around a little bit, the freshest tracks that I can see, which are... Where were they again? I've got them here. Try and just show you. Here we go, beautiful fresh tracks in the sand. Those are definitely from this morning. Sorry, my car's rolling. Just to get out quickly, just briefly to show you what that is for new viewers, because that does really not make any sense unless you are familiar with leopard tracks. Okay, clamb around here. So this is the leopard track that we're looking at with four toes over here and the back of the foot falling here. And the reason I know this is quite fresh is, first of all, it's on top of all of the other tracks, and second of all, this is quite a dense sandy soil, which means that it doesn't have the crisp clear outline that a fresh leopard track would have in soft sand. And she's going straight up this way. Perhaps she stashed the cubs elsewhere. She's not looking at me there, is she? No. You never know with Karula. Let's go see if we can follow them for a little bit and figure this mystery out. Either way, the fact that the carcass is in the tree is a very good sign. It does mean that she's coming back. One way or another, she'll be coming back. She might have decided to keep the dacre for dessert, gone off in search of the main course again. Even if the daycare is a little bit past its sell-by date. Okay, let's go and investigate. The tracks leading straight up towards Elephant Carcass Road. Michael, you've said perhaps something disturbed her and she moved away. Maybe the young Birmingham, the young lioness and the Birmingham male. Not a bad suggestion in that the tracks were heading in this very direction. These are cub tracks as well. These are tiny little tracks. So there were tracks of those lions moving in this direction, but they don't come all the way here. Perhaps she was sort of preemptive in them approaching her or approaching the area that she was in and decided for safety's sake to move the cubs away. That's possible, but chances are what she'd probably have done is tried to stay hidden and secret rather than exposing herself to any kind of a risk. I wonder if this could be a cub going off on an adventure. No, they wouldn't walk all along an open, exposed road like that. That doesn't make sense. The cubs are getting more and more adventurous, but it doesn't make sense to me that they would be that adventurous, that silly and exposed. She's here somewhere. These tracks are crisp fresh. They've left this morning. Not quite sure why. She could be under any of these bushes. Sitting with a full belly, perhaps. This road gets a little bit rocky here. You can still see the odd toe. Not a bad suggestion, Michael. It makes sense, I guess. Maybe she killed something else last night and she's taken the cubs to that, rather. The mysteries of the leopard mind. If only we could think like them for a day, perhaps we'd understand what was going on here. Like why, for example, there are now tracks going this way. Hold on, Michael. Just looking at what's happened here. You're right. Or at least there was an overlap between lions and leopards earlier. I'll show you exactly what I mean in these tracks. And Riola Oha, you wanted to know if we can tell the time of the tracks when the cats came by. To an extent, yes. Usually within a sort of depending on the substrate, between a 6 to 12 hour margin. If it's nice fresh sand and if it's a windy day, we can usually narrow it down to a couple of hours. Sometimes though you just get an instinct that tracks are very, very fresh, which is what I felt with the tracks back there. Now what I need to figure out... Oh, we've got a puzzle here. This needs some serious work, this concentration. Okay, so what we need to figure out here, let me try not to stand on any of the evidence or a leopard cub. Just checking. So what we've got here, I'm trying to think of where the clearest example is going to be. Can you see this one, Viam? That one. If I move my shadow out of it. So what we've got here is a lion track. Much, much larger than that of a leopard. On top of a leopard track going this way. Now, to add to the confusion, so the leopard track, by the way, is here. It's difficult for you to see. This is its toes. This is the back pad. This is where the back pad of the lion has fallen on top of that of the leopard. So this set of tracks was older. Two sets of tracks going this way. Probably three sets of tracks. Karula and her cubs. And then tracks coming back this way. Now, the puzzle, I think she's moving her cubs south away from the lions. I think she brought them back this way for the Dacre kill. And Michael, I think you were right. Or it's a coincidence and she just decided to move them south. No, these... only one set of tracks coming back this way. So did we miss a leopard cub? Or two? Hiding in the vegetation there. Let's carry on a little bit down the road. This is a proper puzzle. I love puzzles like this first thing in the morning. Brent described it as a morning crossword puzzle, and I couldn't agree with him more. It's exactly what it is. Using the clues left behind by the bush to try and figure out exactly what has happened. I think we missed two little leopard cubs. That makes sense. I was sort of looking for Karula, but her cubs would be much, much more shy and instinctively hide away from me without mom. Okay, well, I try and puzzle out this puzzle. Let's head back across to Steph, and perhaps he has some puzzles of his own for you.
We actually do have some puzzles of our own. Thank you very much, Jamie. We've got the puzzle of the lions that we heard last night and where they've been going. We found a very fresh track of a tiny cub, one of the cubs, just one track. Others have been walking across this very hard substrate. You can have a look at what this looks like. It doesn't leave much of a track at all. You can see even if I try and make a footprint, it's just very faint. Now you can imagine something with a soft pad like a lion coming across there is difficult. So we've actually split away from Herbie, and myself and Jandre are on our way up towards some plains that are just in this area here. We want to go see if those lion tracks cross in that area. But while we're at it, you know, something that's happened in the last couple of minutes is this wind has started. It's quite a weird gusty wind that's coming up of the valley, and we literally felt the first stirrings of it. And as it gusted and puffed into our faces, it brought with the most unbelievably earthy, musty, old smell. And we both sat for at least the last 5 minutes just trying to decipher what the smell was. And we came up to a conclusion. We came up to the conclusion that the warm air that is coming out of all the termite mounds in this particular area, and there's a lot of termite mounds around this drainage line, has been lying quite still and probably collecting in these pockets. And what's happened is the wind gusted this musty smell up towards us and puffed it into our faces. And it was that, the wind that has come up cleaning out these pockets of stale and quite stable air that collected over the night. And we were smelling this collection of warm, termite, the wind from termite mounds. I know it sounds pretty weird, but I find it quite amazing trying to decipher things like this. This is quite nice. Here we have what looks to be the beginnings of a rhinomyddin. Now, why is this not elephant? Well, quite simply put, the black color that we see here is diagnostic for white rhinoceros. And although not fresh at all, this is rock hard. As you can see there, I'm probably taking the skin off of my knuckles doing that. It is almost pitch black. And that is because silica starts to oxidize and creates this black layer on top of rhinoceros dung. And then when we start to pick through it or turn it over, we start to see that there's almost no sticks. Now, at this time of the year, you've seen us pick up elephant dung countless amounts of times. And for those of you who are brand new to the show, you'd be expecting to see literally branches inside dung like this. Whereas here we've only got grass. Hard grass, that is a piece of thatching grass, but nevertheless grass. Except there's a stick. Now that is weird. There you're looking at something that is very rarely seen and quite worrying. The fact that white rhinos are busy eating sticks. And I wonder if that isn't a sign of the times, the drought. I've never seen that in rhino dung before. I'm convinced that this is rhino dung. It absolutely doesn't have the characteristic smell of hippopotamus dung. Hippopotamus dung, because they don't have any glands on the outside of their skin secrete all of their information, for lack of a better word, into their dung, and it gives hippo dung a very, very characteristic smell, whereas this doesn't have a smell at all, just very grassy. But the fact that we find that stick there blows my mind, actually, to be quite honest. But yes, this looks like the beginnings of a rhino midden. Now, what do I mean by a rhino midden? Rhinos use dung in their dung piles like signposts, like an information board. If you've seen those boards, I've got a memory in my head about a restaurant chain in this country that has this board, and off to one side is the name of the next restaurant in the kilometers, and the name of that restaurant in the kilometers, and sort of North Pole this way, and London that way, and Sydney that way. And rhinos use middens exactly like that. It's a latrine area. They'll come and use a midden. Other rhinos will come and use this midden, this latrine, this toilet area, and in so doing, pick up the scent markings and the scent trails and information, therefore, about the population of rhino in this particular area. And I'm hoping that that this is the beginnings of one of these middens. It's made up of a collection of two dungs at the moment, hopefully not from the same individual, otherwise it'll be a bit sad. But yeah, that's basically a rhino midden. Now, what else makes middens? Watch out there, Jean-Ray. Hyena have middens. That's something that's less commonly known. Hippopotamus obviously have middens all over the place. This is a very thorny. Hippopotamus have middens all over the place. Civets have middens. Mongoose have middens. What else has a midden? What else has a midden, Jean-Ray? Impala have middens, there's a good one. So quite a few animals actually use these signposts, these middens, these latrine areas as a way to collect information about different individuals all in one place and make it easier to find and therefore to decide what's around. Now, Jason, I'll answer your question in 1 second. I just want to check out my eye. No, it was nothing. They're in the distance. You know, every now and again you have to look at things that catch your attention out here in the bush, because it's literally the flick of a tail or an ear catching an odd, current of the wind that can give away something that's hiding in the shadows. But Jason, you asked me, what is a rhino's digestive system like? Inefficient is probably the word that comes to mind the quickest. So rhinos are hind gut fermenters, the same as warthog, hippopotamus, and elephant. And what that means is that, and zebra, by the way. Now, what that means is that they can take in a large volume of food. They can take in food of varying degrees of nutritional content. So unlike an impala or a wildebeest or a bushbuck, for that matter of fact, that has to have can only eat highly nutritious leaves and then leaves and plants from a climax species. Rhino can eat species of grass and plants that are subclimax, that are even down to pioneer level. They don't have to be high in nutritional value. And they have a digestive system that works inefficiently but can consume large volumes of material and extract not a lot of nutrition from it, but whatever there is there. And they produce massive amounts of dung because of it. And they also get quite bloated. It's quite a gassy process. And you'll notice that things like rhinoceros, elephant, one of the classic ones is a zebra with their belly tummies. To a certain degree, warthog, although warthog can look quite skinny in the droughts, all have these distended bellies, and it's because of this gas that they produce that they get these big, round, rotund bellies. That, and also the volume of food that they eat as well. So I suppose they don't have a ruminating stomach, or they don't have a ruminating digestive system, so they don't chew the cud. Food just constantly goes in, and food just constantly comes out, and they manage to get all their metabolic energy needs from that process. All right, now we are going to carry on hugging the edge of this drainage line, having a look at tracks that are hopefully going to cross our feet at any time of this lion pride. We'll keep you updated. We're going to send you over to Jamie. He's got a little surprise for you.
Ta-da! Not so much a surprise. I started driving along Twin Dams Road, suddenly realized I was forgetting one crucial piece of evidence, and turned around and went straight back, because the tawny eagle was sitting in a separate tree to the one with Karula's kill, which told me one thing and one thing alone, she was still there. So she watched me walk past her, she watched me walk under her kill, she watched me walk past her cubs, and she didn't do one thing. She is such an even-tempered leopard. She really, truly is. She's a wonderful girl. It would be nice if she'd popped her head up, though. It would have been slightly easier to see her. Since I poked my nose right over that drainage line wall, I must have just missed her. Our both cubs are here. We just can't see them at the moment. Sierra, you wanted to know if I ever get nervous getting out of the vehicle with a leopard. No, not really. I don't think I get nervous. I think it's very important to remember that they are very wild animals and they are unpredictable, so you can't take anything for granted in the sense that you've got to be cautious in the way that you approach things. I've had a few very close surprises because leopards often sit still if they think that you haven't seen them. They sit still until you're right next to them, which can make for some interesting moments. I'm going to go and see Anderson later, hopefully, fingers crossed. I want to see if I feel differently once I've seen him, because he's got a very different face. He's got quite a... I think he's got quite a sinister face from the screenshots I've seen. And we were discussing last night about the fact that he's absolutely fine on foot, but he's very, very intimidating. Karula's intimidating as well. I don't know. I think it's just that we've become accustomed to her and each other. And we don't have too much of a problem with her. So you should always be wary in the bush. There's no point in being blasé about things, and there's nothing quite so scary as a leopard coming out of the bushes going brrrr with straight legs and lips curled, which Shadow's done on occasion, not to me, but to some of the other guides. So yes, I suppose it's honest to say yes, occasionally we get nervous, but not really so much when tracking leopard, I find. Hello, girl. Where are your babies? I've just called a taxi into the sighting and he's trying to get hold of me. And unfortunately, right now, the radio comms are a bit blocked up for me to be able to talk to him. I'm just waiting for my turn. So if I go quiet for a second, it's just because I'm listening to the Game Drive channel. You see, she's looking backwards and forwards at her kill and then towards the direction where we saw her cubs. Oh dear. Trying. It's so funny, they're all asking questions of each other about the situation. And I'm trying to tell them what's going on, but I can't. You can see she's still full. She's not all that hungry. She's still panting, as she was last night from yesterday's meal. It's truly extraordinary how fast these cats are going through food at the moment. With her two little cubs, he's keeping them very well fed. Hello to Jenna, who is a new viewer. Jenna, it's lovely to have you on board with us. Jenna, you wanted to know how old Karula is. And the answer to that is she is 12 years old. Close to 12 and a half now. She must be 12 and a half now. And she's got two gorgeous 8-month-old cubs who are somewhere here. Now she's gone round. I think she's going to go up the tree. Let's see, where are... Oh! Spur fowl! I thought for a second that movement was one of the little ones. Let's go see around if we've got a better visual. And how do we tell the leopards apart? Just bear with me one moment because I want to get a view of Karula so I can explain this to you more clearly. Oh goodness. I missed my opportunity. Tried. Okay, I hope she's going to go into the tree and hopefully the cubs will come round to that side of the... There's a big ditch and then a big sort of rise on the other side. I'm just trying to think which is going to be our best approach. Jenna, just in terms of identifying the individual leopards, once you spend a little bit of time with them, it's actually really easy to get to know the individuals. They start to become as unique looking to you as human beings, just from spending lots of time with them. They've got different faces. Now, the official way, or the sort of the scientific way, is to look at the spot patterns on the whiskers, the top row of spots. So you can identify, because they've got different numbers of spots, different individuals have different numbers of spots. So for example, a 3-3 leopard will have three spots on the right, three spots on the left, in the top row of the whisker spot patterns. A 2-3 will have two on the right, because it starts with the right-hand side, left for you watching through the camera, two on the right-hand side of the animal and three on the other. I prefer, personally, to look at identifying spots that are slightly easier to see, rather than the whisker spots. For example, if we look at Karula, and I'll show you, hopefully show you now, Karula's got a wow on her forehead. She has the word wow in her spots. And when I first heard about that, I didn't quite believe it. Once you see it, you'll be converted. Absolutely the case. Tax for Jamie. She's here in the Mulwati drainage on the western side, just as you go in from Spaghetti Junction towards Vulture's Nest. The Bumba's in the Shlashla and both Bunt ones are here, but I've only got visual for now of Mufazi in the Shlashla. Here we go. Oh, no I don't. I thought I only had a view. Aww, how wonderful. Ah, visual of both bunt ones. Yay, look at this. Hello, gorgeous. I'm sorry if I gave you a little bit of a fright this morning, although you don't seem to be any the worse for the wear. Giving a little, I think it's little daughter, a bath. For move, where are you going, girl? Is she going off once again? Or is she just going to go? Yep, she's going to go lie down. The one little cub is here, tail twitching. None the worse for its encounter with a human being on foot this morning, next to Mom's kill. And one up in the tree. My suspicion would be it's the little male. Just going off behavior that we've seen. He's bigger. He's much, much bigger. And he seems to spend a great deal of time eating, as all teenage boys do. He's a growing little boy. He's already, I think, about a third bigger than his sister. And he's thoroughly tucking in. So there we go. Mystery of the morning is solved. Karula did not leave the dacre to go to waste. She did not forget where she put it. Not that I thought that she would, actually. And luckily for her, despite the fact that a bird had knocked it out of the tree, she managed to return in time before the hyenas had managed to find it. All in all, it's worked out very well for the royal family. Hard to believe. We were just sitting here a few moments ago. Sorry, everybody. Texans just called me in to say that there are lions at Galagopan. Goodness gracious, it's all happening here this morning. I'm going to be dashing around like a crazy person, the only one on the vehicle. Natalie in California course, we've got exciting things planned for this morning, and I am definitely going to be going towards Anderson at some point, because I'm so keen to get a chance to see this leopard I've heard so much about. You want to know if the cubs are in danger with Anderson being in the area? No, they're not at all. He's actually not in the area. He is completely on the other side of Arethusa. So, I don't want to take our eyes off our leopards for now, but I will show you a map of where Anderson is and where Karula is now. It's his standard territory. It's on the western fringes of his territory. It's where he overlaps with Tingana. And whilst he might put a little bit of pressure on Tingana in terms of just moving slightly more into his territory, he's not a risk to these cubs. He's not going to come all the way here. You might even find that Karula has mated with him before, but I don't think so. I don't think we have any record of that, of Karula mating with Anderson. A female leopard will mate with as many males as possible so as to trick them all into thinking that her offspring belong to them. Very sensible tactic, because of course the biggest danger to leopard cubs is a strange male leopard. But no, you can rest assured, Anderson is very far away. He's probably, as the crow flies, he's probably about 7 to 8 kilometers away from where we are now. In terms of leopard territories, that's relatively massive. Anderson hardly even comes onto Arethusa, let alone towards Juma. That's got to be the little boy, tucking into that dacre with such relish, using his tail as a counterbalance, and those massive oversized paws to grip onto the jackalberry tree. A perfect leopard spot. Now, for those of you that are only just meeting the royal family, and I know that there are a few of you, that is Hosanna, the little boy, and Shungile, who's just lying down now, is the little Karula's little female. Shungile means beautiful, Hosanna means little chief, which I love. I love that as a name, the little chief. She's gorgeous, isn't she? She's got a W on her forehead, speaking about identifying features. And I actually got so distracted, I completely forgot about that question. My apologies. I was going to show you the wow on Karula's forehead. But I'm sure many of our viewers will be happy to supply you with images that demonstrate what the wow looks like. Because at the moment, Karula has tucked herself behind a bush. We will keep repositioning as the morning goes on. We'll spend a little bit of time with them. You spend as much time as possible with them. It's not often Karula comes to this part of her territory anymore. She spent a lot of time with these cubs to the south of our traverse area, which is why opportunities like this are truly special. And we've actually watched these cubs grow up. Brent was fortunate enough to find Karula the day the cubs were born. Just tiny little barely visible bundles of fluff. And then we didn't see them for 2 months. And they popped out once again. We were so concerned about them. But Karula, proving once again that she is a very successful female leopard, managed to keep them secret and safe. And about 2 months old, we started to see them again. Hard to believe that it's the same leopard cubs. They've just grown so much. Hosanna is rapidly approaching his mother's height, if not her full size. And Ravi, with our leopard safely ensconced up the tree and the mystery of the lions coming through on top of the leopard tracks, he wants to know if we've ever seen lions hunting leopards. Yes, we have. And in fact, not too long ago, we actually had an almost terrifying near miss with Tingana and the youngest lioness from the Nkuhuma pride. So Tingana is the dominant male leopard in this area. His territory fringes on that of the Anderson male. We just happened to be following Tingana. He was hungry. He just finished mating with Shadow. So he was looking for food and he was distracted. And we were just following him through a thicket and all of a sudden this lioness appeared out of nowhere. She had such a head start on him that she got to her full speed, which meant that he had to really seriously launch himself towards a marula tree. Very lucky for him that marula tree just happened to be there. And very considerate of the marula tree. He then performed one of the most spectacular leaps and managed to scale about 10 meters in roughly 3 bounds. And the lioness's momentum carried her halfway up the marula trunk, and then she tumbled back down. Now, one thing that leopards have over lions is the fact that their tree climbing ability is far superior. But it's not uncommon to see a leopard trapped on the outer fringes of a tree, so not these big comfortable boughs that Hosanna is on now, but to be trapped on the skinny branches at the end, barely keeping its footing with a lioness or a lion climbing into the trunk of the tree. Because lions can climb, just not very well. So yes, we have seen that happen on Juma. And it was quite terrifying. It was not so long ago. Probably about, 3-4 weeks ago. My sense of time is not fantastic. Hey, leave some for your sister. I'm just going to chat on the Game Drive channel while I do that. Let's head across to Steph, who's found something wonderfully small.
No, thank goodness Taxon called in that update that the tracks at least of those lions are heading back towards the Galago Pans, because it frees me up to do what I love doing, and that's spending time with my face mere inches off of the ground or from a plant and looking at the other side of these game drives that we do, and that's the smaller side and the sort of the less often shown side. Now, ants are some of the most advanced social creatures, or have some of the most advanced social time around an ant's nest, gives you the most wonderful perspective about what is around and what is happening in this particular patch of bush. Now, we found some ants. What species of ant they are, I have absolutely no idea. But we can tell from the nest around, or the refuse dump around their hole. This is their nest here. The entrance to their nest, they've got two burrows. One is here, and the other one is here. And they have a refuse dump that extends on the periphery of their nest. That's about here. Now, ants are fastidious at keeping their nests clean. And what you can tell from their refuse dump is very similar to what archaeologists and anthropologists can tell from our refuse dumps, from early human settlements in caves and around ancient lakes and river beds. The first thing they look for is the refuse dump, to go in through the pickings and see what was there. And I can say, and I'm going to see if I can find one for you, that these particular ants are preying on a termite colony that's close by. And I can tell you that because all of these little golden globes that you see there. So let's see if I can keep my shaky hand still long enough to allow Jandre to zoom in there. Can you see that? That is the head, the empty head of a termite. Can you believe that? There and there and there and there and there and there and there. There's so many, I can hardly. And here, look here. Here's one coming in with the termite right here. So they look like harvested termites. And these ants are bringing them into the nest. Now, the ants themselves, bits and pieces of the termite to their larvae, to their babies. What happens to this ant? Here comes this titanic struggle. You also saw the Anderson male yesterday, or for those of you who were lucky enough to watch the show yesterday, saw the Anderson male carry a warthog, a fully grown warthog, into the top of a marula tree. Oh, excuse me. Haven't quite shaken my man flu, as Jandre says. And you can have a look at this particular ant performing what is arguably a more titanic feat, in that that particular termite wasn't just carried up to the top of a tree. That particular termite, weighing exactly the same as that ant, the same or roughly the same as the Anderson male, that particular ant had to go down into a burrow. And in relative means, several miles away from here, with his teeth, that was the same weight as what he is, drag it out of the burrow without getting eaten by that thing's friends, and then dragged it all the way back here, several kilometers, to then pull it into the nest. I mean, relatively speaking, it's just something that's absolutely titanic. I just love these types of things. Now, it doesn't look like they're feeding on anything else except for these termites. It'll be quite interesting to actually see where they are fetching these termites from, to be quite honest. And they all seem to be coming from this area. So let's go and have a look. When I'm looking up, I'm noticing that the only place that it could be is that elephant dung over there. Let's go see if we can see some of these ants. Let's see if we can see them here. There's the termites' nests. You can see that they slowly but surely turning this piece of elephant dung into sand with their tunnel construction. And I'm almost certain that if we just spend some time here, we'll find the source of these ants' larders, for lack of a better word. Anna Maria, I absolutely agree with you. It is amazing how strong ants are relative to their size. I mean, some ants, like leafcutter ants, and some of the more predaceous ants out here can carry several hundred times their own body weight in their jaws. Not quite as strong as the dung beetles. The dung beetles here still push several thousand times their own body weight in terms of mass around. And they are the strongest animals on the planet, but ants, absolutely. Now, I know for a lot of you, looking at these ants is probably not the best way of spending your time, so we won't look for too much longer and we'll find something else interesting over here. There's a snail shell that has been crushed, but it left the inside of the central column intact for us to have a look at. How perfectly is that formed? It's the inside of a snail shell. And the central column, let's turn it around, that's the one side. There would have been the entrance where the snail's head used to be. And that would have been the inside of the curl. How cool is that? Looks like something out of the sea, it's crazy. Anyway, we're going to carry on with our day. Let's see if I can cough out this frog I've got stuck in my throat. We're going to send you over to Jamie and Karula. See you later.
I know that feeling very well at this time of year with all the pollen that's about. In the meantime, Hassan is not doing much coughing and lots of eating, and that dacre looks as though it's about to go sliding off the jackalberry tree. Luckily, the cubs have got slightly more skilled at keeping the kills in trees, although there's the odd accident every now and again. Luckily, Mom is always around to pick up their mess. Or, you know, snatch up the bits that they drop, so that she can have some food as well. Remarkably generous in the last few times that we've seen her. She kills something, feeds off it a little bit, and then goes to fetch her cubs and immediately lets them eat first. What you seen? What's there? Looking about and across, already at 8 months of age, very, very alert to the sounds of the bush. And I suppose if they weren't, they probably would not have survived this long. It's amazing the instinct of leopard cubs to keep their ability to keep themselves safe and out of danger. Now, Hosanna seems to have a bottomless pit for a stomach. I cannot believe, after the stomach that he was sporting yesterday with a full of impala, that he is still as hungry as he is. Obviously lots of growing to do. Trying to pull the dacre back into a more appropriate position. Our dacre is not a particularly big meal for three leopards, including two growing teenagers. This is going to be gone by this afternoon. But they might stick around. They've got such full bellies. I don't think anybody's going to feel like moving anywhere. It's kind of like trying to have a nap after a very, very large Sunday lunch. You can see the flies buzzing around. The carcass, because it was left for so long, has attracted lots and lots of attention from the insect life around here. Lots of carcass flies with their bright red heads. Anthony, good morning and welcome to the Sunrise Safari. I'm not sure if yours is a name I've heard before. Perhaps this is your first time on our live safaris, in which case we would like to extend a warm welcome. I hope you are enjoying this sighting as much as I am. Anthony, you want to know why do they put the food in the tree? Well, that is the very clever thing about leopards. First of all, interestingly enough, they don't do it in places where they are the apex predator, where they are the only predator there. And there are lots of places where it's only leopards and cheetah in an area. And then they don't need to bother. But in a reserve like the Sabi Sand, where there are marauding lions and hyenas, and let me tell you, lions are some of the biggest scavengers out here. They can't run the risk of losing their kills. So particularly with hyenas, because lions can climb and occasionally do try and steal leopard kills out of trees, but particularly because of hyenas, a leopard will drag a carcass into a tree to protect it. It's basically like storing it away in a lockable pantry. Or perhaps a lockable pantry is a much better comparison. It's a very good way of keeping it safe. Now, Karula actually put the staker in the tree not 2 days ago. It was knocked to the ground by a tawny eagle because she got distracted, which is fair enough, by the adult impala that she caught. Luckily for her, no hyenas managed to sniff it out, and she was able to recollect it and put it back up into the tree for her cubs. Now, the ability of leopards to hoist is truly incredible. You might not have been watching yesterday's sunset safari, I assume that you weren't, but if you could have seen the footage of Anderson hoisting a massive impala, warthog, into a tree, it gives you an idea of just how powerful these animals truly are. Their neck muscles and the muscles in their legs and shoulders. It's basically carrying, in some cases, the equivalent of their own body weight straight up a vertical climb, almost vertical climb, with it in their mouths, holding it up. That display of strength is, I mean, I've had to hoist impalas, sedated impalas into the back of vehicles before for various reasons to sort them out, to help treat them and so on. They're not light. It's not an easy task. Leopards are truly amazing. This dacre didn't present a Karula with any problems, but even then, that's just testament to her strength. Imagine taking a 12 kilogram, or I'm not quite sure what sort of flour bags you have where you are, but bags of flour, the sort of the standard 12 kilogram bag of flour. Imagine putting that in your mouth and then climbing up a tree. I know that's what they're built for. We're not built for the same thing, but it's still very mightily impressive. Right, Hosanna, while you snack away, I'm going to go and have a look at your mum and maybe your sister, depending on where she is. Let's do a quick reshuffle, reposition, and just go and have a look at what Karula's up to. Perhaps she'll grace us with a glance at her face and we can talk more about the wow on her forehead. Murrily in Illinois, this is a very good question, and that is because, I mean, Karula's approaching 12 years old. She's not old, but she's not young for a leopard either. You wanted to know, is there a kind of a menopause for individuals that live slightly longer than the norm? And yes, all female mammals will go through some form of menopause if they reach that point in their lives. I could see the sister, but she's just so hidden. There's the back of Karula, just talking about her and potential menopause. Because, of course, all female mammals are born with the number of eggs that they're going to produce in their lives. And at some point, that will run out. So, yes, they will go through a type of menopause, but generally, from my understanding, Old age usually catches up with them first. It's a rough life. There's no old age homes out here in the bush. There's no care for the animals. They just have to get on with things. And just like human beings, they lose eyesight, they lose hearing, they lose physical strength and bone mass, and life does get tough. So generally, it's just the fact that they can't sustain themselves in a pregnancy that stops them from falling pregnant. Leopards have been known to give birth to litters, and as viable litters that have survived right up to about 16 years of age, but those are the exceptions rather than the rules. So Karula could go on to have another litter. It is entirely possible. She's still got another at least year tending to these cubs before that thought enters her mind once again. Either way, she has made a remarkable imprint on this area. She's basically supplied this entire place with her offspring. I know that sounds like a ridiculous thing to say. When we look at the leopards that we see regularly, Karula, Tandi, Shadow. Okay, Tingana doesn't count because he's the dominant male leopard. Not that he doesn't count, but he, you know, he's not part of the Karula lineage. Kanuma, Quarantine, Shimambalana. And then a couple of other females that are unrelated. But either way, she definitely has provided the majority of the leopards that we see. Here's a little cub. If we look a little bit to the right, you can just see an ear. Hello. This little sleepy thing. There's Shungile enjoying a nap in the sheltered spot that she's found. Shungile's got a way to go before she first comes into estrus, but when she does, she is fully independent. She will probably take a section of her mother's territory. Now, at the moment, as I said, a lot of this area is populated by Karula's offspring. Now, Lauren, you wanted to know, would her older cubs, so her older generations, potentially mate with her cubs or her? And yes, they would. That sort of thing is relatively common in the cat world, although that is why males disperse away from their natal, or generally disperse away from their natal range. What have you seen, girl? See how alert she's got. Sorry, hold on, we'll talk about this in a moment. A change in body language. She could even be thinking about breakfast number two. Let's just let her listen for a moment. The fact that her cubs haven't stirred, but she has, and instant relaxation. I was going to say, probably suggests that it's something she was interested in hunting, but clearly not. So Laurie, yes, they're not bound by the same moral codes that human beings are, so they will mate with any available partner, whether or not it includes their sons, their mothers, or their sisters or half-siblings. It does actually regularly occur out here. But nature has evolved a way of creating that instinct within males to disperse away from their natal range to help to prevent that. And for the most part, their genetics are relatively resilient to that sort of thing. It takes a few generations of inbreeding before the negative effects are felt. They are poorly, poorly managed. And I mean, to me, it is beyond my comprehension. There are poorly managed areas in South Africa, private reserves and such, where the lions have been stuck in the area that they are. They can't disperse because they're in a fenced area, and they have not been managed in a way that provides fresh genetic changes, where you'll start to see the effects of inbreeding. Whether it's particularly dwarfism, you get cross-eyed lions, you get you just generally get the odd problem with the lions themselves. So their genetics are resilient to a point, and then after that, it starts to have really negative effects. And of course, within nature, the whole nature's geared towards genetic diversity, because genetic diversity provides resilience. The more different types of the more differences you have in each individual species, the better the chance that perhaps if there is a disease outbreak, you'll get one or two individuals that are resistant and therefore save the species. Or you've got animals that are perhaps better adapted to the area that they're in. And that is one of the big reasons why a cheetah, there's a lot of... No, you see, she's up again. What you seen, girl? Is it time for breakfast too? Just want to watch where she goes. She's creeping past Shungile. What has she spotted? Now she could go flat, but I don't think she's going to. I think some poor hapless creature has wandered onto the scene. Now here's what she's doing. She's doing what all leopards are very, very good at. And it often leads people to dismiss the fact that they are hunting because they think they've just sat down and they're relaxed again. And I experienced this firsthand with that wildcat kill that Viam and myself were at not too long ago, where we sat for 2.5 hours with a wildcat that looked like it was sleeping. It was patiently, and it was dozing, but patiently, patiently waiting for its prey to get a little bit closer. And that's what Karula's doing now. She's got up and shifted into a better position where she can see. And now she's just waiting to see if whatever it is happens to stumble into her path. You see anything there, Viam? Just moving trees. She's got an advantage in that the wind is blowing quite strongly in one direction, which is going to blow the scent of herself and her kill away. Alright, we're going to sit tight and see what the queen decides to do. In the meantime, let's head back across to Steph and see what other wonderful, a tiny thing he has found.
Now, that glistening blob of resin that you're seeing over there is what caught my eye on this particularly leafless rus that we have here at the moment. And as I came close to it, I see that this beetle, it's a flea beetle, was feeding on that particular sap run. Now, we speak about sap runs quite often, and you're looking at a prime example of what a sap run is. It's every now and again, for some reason that I've yet to fathom, a tree will start to bleed sap. Now, one of the most common ones that we see over here, the weeping boobean, that endless search that seems to be of mine at the moment. But it looks like it's quite common to a variety of different species. This rus being something that I've never seen before. I've never seen a sap run on a rus like this. And in particular, what's nice is the presence of that flea beetle. Now, this particular year, we've spoken quite a lot about flea beetles, and it's because we just found them. I never even knew that they existed. I've, for the last 20 years, been walking past rusas in this particular area without even noticing these little beetles, and they are phenomenally interesting. One of the reasons is that they only sit in this particular area on the rus. They don't sit on anything else. Another thing is that they take a variety of compounds out of the rus, which is actually a benign plant, it can do nothing to us, and turn it into an incredibly toxic compound that is then concentrated in their larvae, in a beetle larvae. So this beetle will, at a point, bury itself in the sand below this rus, in the sand here, and a couple of centimeters below the surface, they will lay a little egg that looks like a round sand-covered capsule, and in it will be a larvae, a worm, and that worm will have taken the compounds from its parent and from the parent plant and have concentrated it and changed it into an incredibly toxic compound. Something that if you squeeze that tiny little worm onto the head of an arrow or onto your spear and you stick it into something here, will cause cardiac arrest in something like a buffalo in about 40 minutes. Can you handle that? I mean, I just think it's some of the most interesting things. All from these tiny little beetles that are pretty inconspicuous. These little flea beetles. Now, another thing that's quite awesome on this particular rus is the fact that here we find some spider web. And in looking for the owner of this spider web, we found a jumping spider that is somewhere here. I think I've given it, there we go. Let me see if I can point it out at a piece of stick. Last night, a jumping spider spun this web to stay in. and has this morning decided that it wants to hunt, and it's sitting in the knock of the tree in front of the grass blade there that I have, watching the stick. Let's see if we can get him to turn around and face the camera. These are quite simply my favorite insects on the planet. Have a look at how camouflaged that guy is there. Can you see him? Can you see him there, Jeanne? There we go. How amazing is that? Obviously, at the moment, hunting on this particular stick, I have no doubt that they are clever enough to realize that this particular rus has a sap run at the moment. That sap will be attracting a multitude of different insects, and this jumping spider is just waiting to catch one of those insects that come in here. Let's see if I can just move him. He got very, very good vision. Let's see if I can move him back into the camera's view again. There you go. See. Can you all see how fantastically camouflaged he is? Or she is. Don't quite know what sex they are. And all those extraordinary long hairs on their head. I just find that amazing. All on this pretty dead bush by all other accounts. I mean, it's not dead, it's obviously quite alive, evidenced by its sap run, but it has not a leaf on it. Wonderful. All right, let's carry on with our walk. And stand up here after being trapped in its folds. Let's carry on going down. And we're going to cross this drainage line in front of us over here. And I want my wits about me when we do that. The wind has started to pick up and the bushes are shaking around a little bit. So without further ado, you back off to Karula.
Karula for now seems to have given up on the idea of whatever was moving around at the top there and is now glancing longingly up at her hard-won dacre that is currently clutched in the jaws of her son. And I think she's actually thinking about going up to join him, which could be interesting. It's amazing how protective leopards start to get over their kills, or at least over their food, even when they are this young. Sure, there's hardly anything left. Poor Karula. Now, just for a moment, let's just talk about the wow on her forehead. Come, girl, and look this way. She will look this way in a moment and see if you can spot it when she does turn her head for all of our new viewers. And I promise you, once you've got that imprinted in your mind, you'll never forget what Karula looks like. Oh. Okay, or not. Okay. And she pops herself down there at the base of the jackalberry. Bill, talking about dominance within litters, wants to know if there were two male cubs, would they one dominate the other, or would it be a first-come, first-serve basis? So it's not quite like hyena cubs, where there's a very, very clear dominance between two individuals of the same sex. Now, hyena cubs quite literally come out fighting and already established dominance before they've even started exiting the den site itself. Leopard cubs are slightly different. Hosanna is generally not going to come into conflict with his sister. He might growl and snarl at her if he's feeling particularly hungry. And in that case, I suppose he might be displaying it a little bit, but it's not a clear-cut hierarchy. And the same applies with siblings, but what you will see is different characters between leopard cubs. So, for example, Tundi and Shadow have completely different characters. Tundi meaning love. Shadow was actually called Tingana, which meant shy. She was shy when she was a cub. Kunuma and Quarantine, from what I understand, Kunuma always had a slightly more brazen attitude. But for the most part, things are relatively easily settled in leopard families. It might be one day one cub is top dog, the other day it's another one, but for the most part, one personality just tends to be a little bit bolder. But I don't think I'd describe it as a proper dominance hierarchy. And for the most part, they actually live together quite peacefully, even right up until the point that they disperse and they're still hanging around their natal range. Might even encounter them every now and again sharing their kills. Leopard's social structure is a curious thing, I find, personally. I think their social structure is quite unpredictable. They're naturally solitary animals, but at the same time, odd things happen, particularly when food is involved, and occasionally mating, but mating's easier to understand. But where food is involved, their dynamics often switch up. You get older males sharing kills with younger ones, sometimes even in a situation where they might not be related, as with Mvula and Sindile not too long ago. And then the story of a shadow sharing a kill with a Karula, or at least in the same vicinity as Karula and a kill. Yet whenever we see shadow come onto Karula's territory with Tingana, whenever she's mating with him, you can see Karula's nose is thoroughly out of joint. There's stories of grandmothers adopting their daughters' cubs. There's all kinds of interesting things that leopards do. And David in Napa, speaking of that, and of course competition around food, you want to know why leopards don't eat together as lions do. I think it's just, again, it's the difference of their social structure. And it reduces the competition between them, especially, and also, it's the position that they're feeding in. So it's not that easy for two leopards to feed at the same time in a tree, particularly when the kill is a small kill. When it's on the ground, it's slightly easier, and occasionally they do feed. If it's a big carcass, they do feed from opposite ends at the same time. They don't seem to like being in such close proximity to each other, though, around a kill. They're not as good at sharing. And lion prides, of course, aren't actually all that good at sharing either, although eventually each gets its place. There's a lot of growling and rumbling. Leopards adopt a totally different approach, quite a peaceful approach to mealtimes, particularly where mother and cubs are involved, or at least what we've seen from Karula. But I've seen mothers and offspring come into conflict before over food. We've seen Shadow snarl at Sindile a few times, and we saw Shadow's young cub a couple of months ago snarling at Mom to keep her away from the kill. I've heard some interesting stories. I was chatting to Tristan from Simbambili last night about Tiani and Saleeshe. Saleeshe is a female leopard to the west. She's moving slightly into Arethusa, but she's generally on the western fringes of our Traverse area. Her daughter, Tiani, is not even fully independent yet. She's still, she's only a year and a half old. She hasn't quite got to that point, although she is getting there, and Saleeshe has been seen mating again, which means that very soon Tiani will be out on her own. What was fascinating about the stories about Tiani, who is rumoured to be Anderson's daughter and is quite a large female, is that she'll wait for her mother to scent mark, and then she walks up to her mom's scent markings and marks on top of it, and then snarls at her mother whenever her mother comes near it, as if to say, no, this is mine now. Which is interesting. Interesting behavior. She's developed a technique now. When hyenas steal her kill, if she doesn't actually physically tackle them, if there's too many for her to tackle, because she has been known to take on hyena every now and again, which is extraordinary for a female leopard, she then climbs into a tree, apparently, and just whacks them on the head. So she'll sneak down, whack the hyena on the head, and then run back up the tree again. And sneak down and whack it on the head, and then run back up the tree again. I mean, how's that for personality? That is definitely a leopard with an individual sense of self. The first time I ever saw Tiani, I was on a bumble with the FC ladies, and we were on Simbambili. And there she was. Her mom had lost the kill to the hyenas, and this leopard was sitting within 5 meters of that hyena, seriously, seriously contemplating going for it. And that's unusual, especially in females. She's also rumoured to have killed an impala when she was 9 months old, 9 to 10 months old. But I mean, look at this. Hosanna is 8 months old. So he's nearly that age now. How on earth she managed that, I'm still not entirely sure. But the guides that say they were there swear that she did that. I doubt it was an adult impala, though. Still, impressive. Anyway, so yes, it's all about leopard characters and personalities. And I do think that leopards, particularly of the big cats, have individual personalities. Mvula's at Sydney's Dam. Yes. Sorry, just bear with me one moment. I just want to... Last station, sorry, confirm Ingwe at Sydney's Dam. Do you think it would be visible from the cut line? Copy that, thank you. I've been trying for 2 days to get Mvula on camera. Let's do it. Let's do it. Thank you very much, Karula and Cubs. We will return to you. They're not going to be gone by this afternoon, so we will return back to them. It's been so long since we've seen Mvula. We're going to have to do a mad race to get there. I'm so hoping I tried this yesterday. It didn't work out in my favor. He's far away. He's at Sydney's Dam, so we can't go onto Buffalo's Hook, but I still think it's worth doing. Bye-bye. We'll see you later. And then we can start going to Anderson. I mean, I know this is ridiculous, because it's just me, just little old me in the vehicles this morning. And Brent is, Steph's very kindly given Brent a morning off so that he can have some rest. So it's not a broken car, nor is it a broken Brent. It's just a chance to have a little bit of a breather. Okay, I think we should do it. We've got a mad race ahead of us. So there you go, curious one, and those of you wondering where our second vehicle is, it's just to give Brent a little bit of a break, since as we've spoken before, we're on skeleton crew, and we've still got rehearsals coming up again next week, so it's just a break. In theory, it'll be my turn tomorrow morning. Okay, I'm going to do a manic race that's going to take me a little bit of time. While we do that, let's go back to Steph for an update.
Now, this gale that's blowing in, of course, that started a little while ago with a gentle puff up a valley giving us some scent of termite mounds, has now turned into what feels like a hurricane at this particular level. But also, what it's allowed us to do is it's allowed us to view what otherwise would have been invisible. And that is the web of a grass spider. Now these spiders average some of the fastest spiders on Earth. In actual fact, the grass spider is rated in the Guinness Book of Records, was at least until the 90s. It was rated as the fastest spider on Earth. And I'm gonna see if I can entice the spider out just by tickling the web a little bit. They actually got very good eyesight, and I think she's actually seen me. No, she doesn't want to come out. She's sitting there. No, seen me again. Come on. Now, why they need their speed is basically because this horizontal web traps insects that walk over it. She then comes, before they can loosen themselves, she comes running out across her web, bites them, wraps them up in some silk, and then takes them into her retreat to eat them at leisure. And the dust has stuck to the sticky strands. The dust that's blowing around here now is stuck to these sticky strands, which has unveiled this particular spider to us. Otherwise, these webs are pretty much, the only time you see them is when they go and construct a web inside a piece of dung that is quite stationary, but they're almost all over the place. And it's these webs, as well as the other horizontal webs in the trees, the tropical tent web spiders, that give us those wonderful views on misty mornings when the dew condenses on the web itself, and then we can see them dotted throughout the trees, and it gives you a true impression of how many spiders are actually out there. Now, I don't know the exact amount of spiders per square meter out here in the Kruger National Park. A square meter is basically a yard by a yard, for, you know, just for easy comparison. Not much bigger than the space I'm sitting at the moment. But definitely more than one, I would hazard to guess, probably around about a dozen or so spiders per square meter is the average of spiders in the Kruger National Park. And one of the, let's see if she'll come out now. We've given her a little bit of time to acclimatize herself to me. She doesn't seem to be wanting to come out there at all. And I don't want to do any further damage to her web. Not that the wind will do anything less, and not that it's actually a detrimental to her. She'll spin up the damage quite quickly. But Jeffrey, you've wanted to know, or good morning, firstly, you wanted to know, is the thin abdomen on a spider distinctive between the species, the sexes? Does it mean that it's a male? I would say no, generally speaking, Jeffrey. I would say that by far the better indicator is the pedipalps, which are those two appendages that come out just next to the jaw. On males, the pedipalps tend to be overdeveloped. They tend to have two clubs on the end, or to be long, and to be used in displays quite often. And so for me, a distinctive feature of male spiders is these overly developed pedipalps. And in the case of tarantulas, or in the case of baboon spiders, the first set of legs that come out just close to the head have a distinctive spur that comes out of the leg. It looks like a tooth comes out of the leg, and they use that spur to hold the female's jaws apart so that she doesn't eat him while they're busy mating. And so male tarantulas or male baboon spiders have that spur on the front of their legs to, like, say, wrestle this female into submission, basically, and hold the jaws away that she doesn't eat him in half. But I would say by far and wide the pedipalps on the other end of the body, on the head side of the body, rather than the thin abdomen. Why would you say the abdomen? It could quite possibly be that female spiders are in general quite large, and much larger than male spiders. And relatively speaking, a female spider does have an abdomen that looks distended, or looks larger than a male. So perhaps that's where you're getting your observation from. I can fully empathize with that. But you also get females that are hungry or have just laid eggs, and in that sense, their abdomens will be quite skinny and compressed, really. And so that could confuse things a little bit. But definitely look for those overdeveloped pedipalps, and then those mating spurs on the front legs of the baboon spiders. Alrighty, and let's carry on. We have, as you see, made our way back onto quarantine clearings. Now, Bobby, you've just asked, did I ever finish making that bow that I made? And I presume you're talking about that little mini bow, or as I'd like to say to everybody that's been teasing me about that from the day I started it, my bow that I made to scale. I'll increase the scale. Yes, I did finish it. I actually finished it as the walk finished. I then strung it with a piece of dental floss, and I managed to shoot a porcupine quill a good 15 yards across the DRC's common area. Something that I tried to show off at length that evening, but to which never really made much of an impression on my teammates and my comrades. Jandre says he liked it though. So it did actually work. I then subsequently broke it by pulling it too hard. I tried to get the porcupine quill to fly straight across the DRC and broke the arms. But what it did show me was I had a critical design flaw. I tapered the bow too quickly, and it went too skinny too quick, and it allowed too much flex, and not at the end of the bow where it was supposed to be. So I'm glad that I did that in actual fact, and I will be making more bows. In actual fact, upscaling them gradually from this size. For those of you who are just joining us, I made a bow for an elf or a dwarf about this big last week. I'll upscale it to one this big in the near future, and hopefully I'll make a full size version before I get too old and grey and senile. But please feel free to carry on reminding me about these little endeavours I promise you and mostly never ever get to. Zach, while we make our way across quarantine clearings over here, good morning, Zach. You've asked me, how many years does it take to become a field guide, or how much schooling do you need to become a field guide? Zach, to become legal in this country, you need about 3 months of schooling and 3 months of experience. To get the top qualifications in guiding, you need to study for about 15 years. So some of the top qualifications, if you don't stop studying and you don't take breaks in your 15 years, it'll take you 15 years to get some of the top qualifications. And by that I mean some of the special knowledge and skills guiding qualifications that you can achieve. You need thousands of hours of experience just to be eligible to write the exam, let alone get the qualification. And some of your tracking qualifications, in particular your senior tracking qualification, I've known some guys to take 9 years just to get the final qualification. And others who will spend their entire careers trying to get these qualifications. So it can be a lifelong pursuit. And the nice thing is that there's this range of qualifications that you can achieve throughout your guiding career if you choose to take this. And so studying is pretty much never ending. And then, of course, the qualification is really just the beginning part of whatever you're studying. I mean, it's just the entry exam into... And to open up your eyes into this field, you never really stop here. I mean, there's always some new egg to look at, or some new insect that you don't understand anything of, some new behavioral pattern in a mammal here that you've never seen before. So you pretty much never stop learning. Quite recently, I'd like to say that our biggest learning curve was going into the Masai Mara. Most of the guiding books that we study from out here are based on studies that were done in East Africa in between the 1960s and the 1990s. And when we got there, we realized, and this is, I mean, we've been looking at animal behavior here and the way things are done on the backs of those books for the last 20 odd years. And when we got to the Masai Mara, we realized that not only did things change from what was depicted in these books, but things were very different to what we expect here. There was a different way to the way the animals behaved there, in particular reference here to lion and hyena activity. So, you know, in conclusion, before I end up speaking myself into circles over here, and I'd like to say that you never really stop learning, actually. You know, there's always something new, and there's always a new book being written, and there's always some new information that's being gathered from somewhere. But anyway, on that point, we're going to send you back to Jamie, I think, who's now done what she needed to do and has an update for you.
Perfect timing. We have nearly arrived on Buffel's Hook Cutline. I hope everybody's keeping fingers and toes crossed, because the leopard is currently 200 meters away from our boundary, which is roughly 200 yards, just to the north of our boundary. Tax is with him, keeping me updated. Turns out, will you believe this, it's not Imvula. After that mad rush, it's not Imvula. It looks like it might be Tingana, but it's still not 100% clarified. So let's go through and see if we can see which individual this is. A crazy morning. Obviously Tingana moved into that area last night, if it is him. Imvula was in that spot. Now, Imvula is the dominant male leopard in the north, but he is getting, he is quite a bit older than Tingana. Tingana is massive. He's bigger than Imvula, but they sort of seem to have come to a truce in that Buffel's Hook boundary is generally the line. But Tingana has been known to chase Imvula right into Manuleti on the odd occasion. So, the question is, who have we got here? I'm just listening to update, sorry. It sounds like he's just stumbled upon a herd of impala. Come on, Tingana. Come and say hello. We haven't seen you in ages either. It was worth the risk. It was worth the risk and excitement, and Karula and her cubs, we did actually have to make space for other vehicles. Ephraim was making his way into the sighting. It's got to be here, this water buck. Let's just stop and listen. The water buck was staring off to the north of us before we stopped. Such a pity it's so windy. Can't hear what's happening with the alarm calls. Can hear Tax's vehicle a little bit further. There's impala alarm calling just a little bit to the north of us. an interesting coincidence that Viola Orhart happened to ask that question. VM and I were just talking about that now. Now, Viola would like to know how far leopards can see. Sorry, Viola. Just listening for the updates on where the leopard's going. What? I don't understand. Sorry, Viola. Yeah, me too. Frantic impala. Tex is saying the impala is stuck in the tree. I don't know if that means Tingana's caught him. Let's just go back a little. They are furious. This leopard is so close to us. Sorry, Viola, I haven't forgotten you. I promise you I'm going to answer your question in a moment. With that amount of alarm calls, he's either caught one or he's been spotted and that's it. Then he's going to have to move on because there's no way he's going to manage to hunt anything with everything being alert to his presence. I think it's actually better to be further back so at least we can look down into the road. A little bit forward. I can actually see Taxon. Oh, so close. There, yes. Perfect. Well done, VM. Looking nervous. I can still hear them alarm calling. And Viola, I'm going to answer your question I'm just going to put it on the back burner for one moment. Just while we wait to figure this one out. And just keep checking behind me as well in case he comes across that side. You can see they're all looking north, which isn't great for us. And now all racing off. I'm very confused. I'm going to have to find out from Tex afterwards what he was talking about, because he just started laughing and said, okay, it's gone. And I assume that means the impala managed to free itself. I think it did actually get stuck in a tree. I think the impala, from what I can hear on the game drive comms, I'm now very confused. I know. Now they're saying it's Kojima. Oh dear. This has all gone wrong. It was worth it though. And there's still a chance he might come sprinting across the road if it's Kojima. Tex, sorry. Just to confirm, you no longer have visual of that animal. Okay, copy that, thank you. Mobile or static? Sorry, everybody. Okay, copy that. Thank you. I'm on the cut line now. I've got visual of those marlar. I'm just going to stand by here for a little bit. Okay, now we have some clarity. It's not Gujima. He meant the impala Gujima runs away. So here's what happened. The leopard was on its way south towards the boundary and changed his direction because the impala had started alarm calling. The impala were alarm calling because an impala had managed to get itself stuck on a branch. I'm not 100% sure how. I don't know whether it tried to jump or maybe it was thrashing and it got its horns caught. You know how the rams thrash the bushes? The leopard is still there. He went to go and try and catch the impala that was stuck in the tree. Somehow missed, and the impala managed to break free and has made a very lucky escape. We're looking at probably some of the luckiest impala in the whole of the northern Sabi sand, because how an impala manages to get stuck in a tree and still manage to escape a leopard, maybe unluckiest and luckiest at the same time. So that's what's happening there. And in this brief moment of peace, Attack says that the leopard is still sniffing around that area. There's no way he is going to be able to catch those impala now. Not a chance. Not with them being as panicky and on alert as they are, and the fact that they've seen him. So he's lost his element of surprise, and he's lost the impala that was stuck in the tree. Now there's a good chance he's going to keep coming across in this direction. So what I'm going to do, because I've got a fix on these impala now, is I'm going to just move a little bit further back. And while we do, we can answer poor Viola's question, which got put on the back burner temporarily. So in terms of leopard eyesight, Viola and myself were just talking about that, which is why it's so uncanny that you happen to ask that exact question. When you talk about the fact that domestic cats are somewhat short-sighted, and they've got quite a limited field of vision in front of them. And we were wondering about leopards and the way that their vision might be geared. So the vision of predators is not as good as a human being's. They cannot see as far and they cannot see in as much detail. This water bug is still here. But they are very much attuned to movement. Leopards can see as well in the dark as they can see during the day. The only difference is, of course, that at night there will be no color vision at all. So the cells in their eyes will not be able to, the light reflected will not be able to reveal colors. So predators do have limited color vision, not as good as primates, as human beings, but they do have limited color vision. And in terms of distance, I actually don't know what distance a leopard or a lion is able to see. I mean, I've seen them spot movement at easily 200 meters, but how much detail they see is a different story. How close the prey has to be for them to gauge well what that prey is going to do. Hello, Mr. Waterbuck. You must be totally befuddled as to what on earth is going on. Come on, leopard. I've done a mad rush all the way here. Please, Tingana, come this side. Come and join us here. I can still hear the impala alarm calling. Shame, they have had a very bad day. James Bear, speaking of the Mvula Tingana confusion that we've just experienced, and while we look for our leopard as it makes its way out, I know that Steph is just sorting something out on Bushwalk, so he's heading back to camp for now, so we'll just stick here and wait patiently. James, you wanted to know what's happening with Mvula and, what happens with an old male leopard that is no longer able to compete for a territory? Will they just wander from territory to territory in the hope of finding a vacuum? What have you seen, Waterbuck? Keep hoping. Shame. This Waterbuck's so unsettled now. Sorry, James. This Waterbuck's so unsettled it knows that the wind is howling, it can't smell, it doesn't know what the impala are shouting at, it could be a lion. Yeah, better safe than sorry, I think. I think that was a wise decision, Mr. Waterbuck. Not that Tingana would probably go for a waterbuck that size, but you never know. So James, what will happen with an old male leopard becomes what's known as a dispersal male. So essentially they go and they do what young males do, which is move from place to place, just trying to avoid the attentions of the dominant male of the area. It's actually a little bit further back in this direction. Come on, Tingana. I think we might not get lucky here. I was hopeful, but I was only so long. I can sit here for. Panicked impala racing off. Okay, we'll just sit here for a little bit longer in the hope that this leopard does come south. And talking about dispersal leopards and the fact that once they do get older, they will, sorry, just listening to Game Drive comms again, they will disperse. They will move from place to place to place and attempt to find a spot that does have a vacuum. What you'll often find with old male leopards is they tend to hang around lodges, interestingly enough, looking for any kind of, they often scavenge, especially when their teeth start to fail them and their muscles in terms of hunting. Actually, that applies to females as well as males. They'll spend a lot of time doing that. So it is just a matter of staying under the radar. They no longer patrol territories, they do not call, they do not scrape or urine scent mark. They just try to be as subtle as possible. They basically revert back to the behavior that they would have demonstrated when they were little, when they just dispersed away from their mothers. And just to let you know, we've still got a little while to go, but there will be a school drive for some of the children from South Africa, a school in Johannesburg, in the next half an hour or so. I'm not quite sure what the time, the next 40 minutes or so. So just for our regular viewers, you know the drill. We chat to school kids and we take the questions from school kids. Always great fun and of course of vital importance, since the guardians of the future of conservation will be the next generation. So it's something wonderful that I really enjoy doing. So just to let you know, there will be a school drive. Oh dear. I'm sorry, everybody. We raced off in this direction. Came so close and yet so far. It's a strange feeling of deja vu. Exactly the same thing happened yesterday afternoon, except it was in Mvula and not Tingana. Oh well, worth a try. Anna Marie, I promise you I haven't forgotten about Anderson. There's no way on earth I would forget about Anderson, and in fact, I'm just busy making a decision about what we should do. And I think we should leave this. Taxon will, there's no point, we don't have anything to keep ourselves distracted here. And because we're only one vehicle, we can't really wait. I think we should go back to Anderson. Jump on the lineup and go and see him. And Taxon will hopefully keep us updated about what this leopard does. Maybe he'll come and cross back onto Juma and we can see him later on the sunset safari. Don't worry, I haven't forgotten. I have not forgotten at all. I've just been not killing time. I've just been waiting for all the other vehicles to pass through Anderson. Hopefully, I'm actually really hoping that'll mean we get to spend some serious quality time with him in an area that's generally quite busy. But it's time to go. Time to move off and go off in search of Anderson. It's finally time for me to see the leopard that has supposedly broken all the records. Oh, hello. With a minor roadblock in between. Herd of elephants has just come dashing out. They too will have heard the alarm calls and they too will be quite nervous. It's windy today. Hello, girl. It's all right. It's okay. You can see they're unsettled. We'll stop here. We'll give them plenty of space as the biggest female puts herself between us and the herd to make sure that she keeps them safe before bringing up the rear and shepherding all the youngsters off to safety. Elephants are nervous creatures. It's something, especially in the wind, and even the presence of predators that in all likelihood are absolutely no threat to them will provoke some kind of a response, whether it's nervous running away or an aggressive chasing response from them. They do not like the presence of predators, and they definitely do not like wind. And I've noticed more and more unsettled elephant herds. What's interesting, and the reason why we're seeing so many elephants, having now been through to the western side, other side of Arethusa, they didn't have any rain. We had rain. It's green here. Just imagine what this place would look like if we hadn't had rain. That's what it looks like on that side. It's completely barren. So what that means is that these animals are pushed together into the places that have had rain, that have got some greenery. And that's why we're seeing so many buffalo herds. We're seeing so many elephants. This is one of the few places that has available food. The southern Sabi sand has had no rain at all. So just imagine, at our worst point, just before it did rain, they haven't had any rain since then. It's a terrifying thought. And that's why we've got so many elephants, and they're put under pressure. They're stuck together in quite a limited areas, competition for food, competition for water, constantly getting into each other's space. And that's why the animals have been so unsettled. I don't want to risk losing our signal by going all the way around to the gate. So we'll cut through, we'll take a shortcut through Sandy Patch. Does mean we have to wait for the elephant crossing on our way to the Anderson Mail. Michael says this will be his first time seeing the Anderson Mail and that he's super excited. I'm super excited too. It's my first time as well, Michael. Definitely an appealing prospect. Okay, let's just give these Airlies a little bit of space on this windy day. Sweet. Reaching out to the youngster briefly there. You can see they're confused. They don't actually quite know where to go. And very, very nervous. When you see elephants pushing through vegetation rather than... Oh, they're actually having a bit of a scuffle there. Rather than using the regular game paths, when they actually shove through vegetation like that en masse, it's usually a very clear sign that they are in a hurry to be wherever they want to be or get away from where they are. You can see the wind is really starting to howl again, which is relatively standard, I guess. I don't know, I've never lived in such a windy place in the bush. This month has been incredible. Okay. I think let's shuffle past them. They're not comfortable. I don't want to stop for too long and make them feel even more uncomfortable. So we'll leave our Ellies for now and we'll let them get on with their day-to-day business. They are also moving into some very dense vegetation. I think let's get ahead. I also want to go and see if the Anderson male really is as big as everybody says he is. I assume he must be, everybody says it. But it's not a case of the I caught a big fish kind of scenario, where it gets exaggerated over time. Vim, you've seen Anderson, haven't you? You have. Ah, you see. I feel like I'm one of the only remaining people to have not seen him. We're definitely going there. We've still got a very long way to go though. We've got to get to the southern end of Arethusa, so it could take us a while. We'll have to stop for things along the way to keep things entertaining. Tax, I'm going to be leaving that area and make my way to the west. Copy that, thank you. I'll check in with the other guys a bit later. Okay, for now Tingana has gone flat and settled down, so he's enjoying a little bit of rest, so he's not come through to the boundary, so it's a good thing we made the call we did. In the meantime, while we race through to Arethusa, let's head across to Steph, who I think has got things back up and running once again.
All right, you are back with us, and it's a bit chaotic over here. We've come live like right at the DRC at the time when all the staff here at Juma get going for the morning. But I really wanted to show you something quite interesting, and it's why we don't drive over dung sometimes. It just looked quite nice, so that's why I want to show you. Here is the tracks of a dung beetle. This is the tracks of a dung beetle. And when you follow the line of the dung beetle, you can that some dung at the end of it. And this is the terminal point of those tracks. This is where the tracks stop. The other tracks are the tracks stop. And when you flip this over, transport this morning. Poor dung beetle got by the staff transport this morning. But it's just such an interesting thing. Rolling his dung ball, didn't quite see whoever was driving over it, didn't quite see it, and drove over it. And that's why we try and avoid over here, while we try and avoid the dung. But isn't that just the interesting thing? Tracks of the dung beetle, squashed dung ball, and then when I turned it over, boom, the dung beetle that is underneath it. Poor thing. Alrighty, let's carry on with our walk. Create some distance from the DRC and all its hammering in it. I'll tell you, it is quite an experience doing a segment for you from here. We are busy renovating everything around the DRC, and so it's just a constant din of hammering, angle grinding, shouting, mixing of spades, laughing, joking around, radios blaring out the most. I suppose it's a cacophony of different types of sounds. I wouldn't quite call it a noise. Some of them in isolation are quite nice, to be quite honest. And now we are back. We will be going black screen a little bit. There seems to be a problem with one of the connections that we have. And so every now and again, if we do disappear from sight behind a black screen, don't go anywhere. It's just one of those things about bringing a live show to you out here in the bush. For those long-term viewers, you'll know that it's a constant, basically, of what we try and do over here. All right, let's try and get up onto quarantine. Michael. Good morning to you. You've just asked if we have any updates about the clay pot that we found in the termite mound. I don't, Michael, to be quite honest. The story stays exactly the same as where we left it. And I'm literally just waiting for the owner of this particular reserve, Mr. Yuri Moorman, to come and spend a decent enough amount of time out here. He literally, for the last 6 months, hasn't had 48 hours spare to come here, come into the reserve to come and do his business over here. Every time I've asked him if he's got a spare minute or two, he says no, he doesn't. So at the moment, the story stays open and unresolved, which I suppose he'll eventually calm down again. His year probably will come to a close as summer starts to come in. The days are getting longer, and of course, everybody's work hours are increasing. So we're getting more done in a shorter space of time, which is what I'm hoping for, at least anyway. So Michael, hopefully we can bring you a conclusion to that very soon. Other than that, and I'm going to ask Herbie and Rexon to try and do it. Herbie and Rexon are here and quite involved with the local community. Failing getting Mr. Moorman on board to come and help us uncover the mystery that is this pot, what we'll do is we'll ask Herbie and Rexon to try and gather the troops, so and to take us out there and to do an explanation for us. So I won't let it go on indefinitely, don't worry. We'll come to a conclusion soon enough, and then I'll share it with everybody. That's the idea. Wow, I must be honest with you, this wind is just, I don't know quite what it's bringing. As we said this morning, the red sky in the morning equals a shepherd's warning, so the saying goes. Red sky at night equals a shepherd's delight, as I know it. And it's proven to be quite effective, that particular bit of weather forecasting. So this morning's blood red sunrise that we had heralded something that was happening. And although there has been no rain forecast here until next week sometime, you never quite know. You never know what this is bringing in. What I can say though is that uncommonly we've had wind from the same direction for almost 10 days now. I would say definitely longer than a week. We've had wind from a southerly direction. Hasn't brought us much except for cloud. We've had quite a few overcast days, but no rain. And as you can see, like, but going forward, yeah, not quite the Cape gales that we used to in the Western Cape and near Cape Town, but definitely uncharacteristically strong. Let's go and visit this gardenia tree. Oh, this apple leaf is about to, oh, and has some flowers on. You can see, it's going to be, Jandre is going to swear at me a lot when we finish with this, but you can see that this tree is basically covered in little blossoms, and it's a violet colored blossom, and the apple leaf trees, when they put on a show of flowers, really don't hold back on anything. They really do a proper job, and you can see some, well, you might not be able to see while you're getting seasick. Green of a violet color there, and that's where this tree gets its specific name from, a violence profusion of violet colored flowers that it has. And that will literally be pollinated by bees, a lot of bees in actual fact will pollinate these flowers, and then the flower petals rain down on the floor and litter the area around them. I've actually got a flower here. Let me see if I can pick up a few for you. They literally litter the floor, and just like I'm doing now, once they've been pollinated, they litter the floor. But just have a look at that color. Isn't that the most incredible thing? One of these springtime joys that we have out here. That's the actual flower. I'm going to see if I can open it a little bit. Gorgeous little thing. So that's the apple leaf flower, or the Phalaenoptera violentia is the genus and the specific name. Getting its name, its specific name, because of that violet spray of flowers that it has. But let's walk over to this gardenia tree. I want to This is another tree that puts on quite a nice show, but it's an evening show rather than a daytime show. And these trees, they get pollinated by moths. This is the Lowveld gardenia. And we should start to see some white flowers on it. They're relatively big flowers. This one doesn't even have a flower bud yet. Which is sad because I can't show you one, but also not unexpected. And they will obviously be coming. Whew, I tell you, being out of the wind is just a pleasure. This is an incredibly effective windbreak where we're standing at the moment. It is allowing me to speak without having to shout into the wind and also feeling like I'm walking headlong into a gale. But you can see from the trees around us, just busy shaking in the breeze. I mean, it's not moving a hair on my head. Not that I have much hair to blow them with. Anyway, that's the way it is. All right, we've heard some elephant, the same elephant that we saw early this morning. We've heard them just on the edge of quarantine here. Busy screaming at something. It's not those lion. Those lion tracks, as we noted, walked almost full circle around quarantine and then walked all the way through back to Galago Pan. As expected this time of year, lions don't go far away from water at all, at least permanent water. And true to form, or true to character, those lions have gone somewhere into that thick, thick block that's around Galago Pan. Now, another thing that we did a bit earlier this morning was look at a rhino midden, or at least what I thought was the start of a rhino midden. This is an impala midden. This is the herd of impala that live on quarantine. They live in the evenings on quarantine. As the year progresses, and eventually, for them at least anyway, terminates in the rut, which happens in May, this midden pile will be added to and added to and added to every time impala stop in this area. Generally speaking, male impala are the ones that add the volume. And also the concentration of dung in any one pile. And that's because male impala are compelled to defecate on top of another male's dung. So one male will defecate and urinate on a spot. The next male, in a form of dominance, will come and urinate and defecate on top of that male's dung pile. And it's sort of like this one-upmanship that has no point except for to an impala, really. And looks quite comical because they'll have turns defecating on one another's dung pile, and this creates this midden. Not to say that females don't come and use middens. They will absolutely use a midden. And they will, but they tend to be not quite as compelled or compulsive, one on top of another until they've formed this big pile. But we are going to carry on across this open patch here in this gale, and we're going to send you over to Jamie, who's got an update for you.
Good, thanks. Hi, everybody.
Hi.
Sorry, everybody. Just bear with me one moment. Sorry. Oh, awesome. Thanks. Oh, wonderful. Okay, perfect. Thank you. And still a lineup. Okay, perfect. Thanks very much. Cheers. Hi. Sorry, everybody. That was awkward timing. I just had to stop and get an update from Elephant Plains about what's happening out here. So, apparently there's still a massive lineup for Anderson. Now, as far as I know, Anderson is a two-vehicle sighting. The reason behind that is he's not fully comfortable with vehicles, so he has to be treated with a very gentle approach, which means that only two vehicles at one time will go through and see him. Now, just bear with me one moment. Sorry, I have to do this. I have to just jump onto the Game Drive channel. Morning stations in the west. I was wondering if I could come into the Ingala lock. Copy that, thanks very much. Well, we might not be able to get into Anderson just yet, but we can go into the lions. Isn't that exciting? Okie dokie. Let's go and find out what's happening. Must be the Tsalanas again. Wonderful, I haven't seen them in forever. And I think they are somewhere here. I hope they are somewhere here. Apparently there's one of them here on a kill somewhere here. And then there's four of them at the waterhole. I'm not quite sure which one I'm going into. We'll figure it out as we go along. I think let's put ourselves as close as possible to Anderson. So let's go to the ones at the waterhole. Oh, Arethusa's been exciting over the last 2 days. Two animal sightings that we have not had a chance to see in a very, very long time. I last saw the Tsalalas. I'm so excited to see how big the males have got, because the last time I saw the Tsalalas was when they were scavenging off the buffalo kill near Red Dam. That must have been October last year. That's a year ago. That's terrifying. It was when Karula was mating with Tingana in that area. And they were scavenging off a buffalo carcass, and then the Tsalalas found them. And Tingana and Karula were so caught up in each other that they didn't realize that the lions were there. And the young males, because young male lions in particular are very, very aggressive in terms of trying to pursue other predators. It's a competition thing. It's also a youth thing. They're still learning, they're learning their boundaries, and they ended up chasing Karula right up to the top of a knobthorn. We never found out where Tingana went. He was obviously fine. He's alive and well to this day, thank goodness. But it was a very narrow miss. Actually, that goes back to the question we were speaking about earlier, about seeing lions hunt other predators, hunting leopards. Hold out, everybody. I know this is minor compared to the weather that some of you in the States have been experiencing, but it's very windy on this airstrip. Going to cling on to my earpiece so that I can hear what's going on. No point in listening to the sounds of the bush because I'm not going to hear any of them. Shame. And the one thing I have noticed is that the animals are all helter-skelter at the moment. All of the prey species are just dashing about manically, trying to escape the wind, and also so nervous. I wonder what this wind is bringing. I can say one thing though, I would not want to land a plane on this airstrip today. At least it's not gusting. At least it's one standard direction. Still nervous little boys. Look at that face. My goodness, but they've grown. The three young males of the Tsalala pride. Last time I saw them, I think they were only about a year and a half old. The others are on the opposite side of the airstrip. There's one female. Must be the subadult because I can see a tail. One female, and then the two males off to the right of her. A little bit further, there we go. There's the two other males. They were playing, they were the ones that were playing, but unfortunately they've settled down now. It's very common to see animals around this airstrip, which brings us to David in Napa. You know which animal particularly likes to lie on the airstrip, David? Is lions. Because the tarmac heats up and it's nice and warm. Although on a day like today, the wind is going to mitigate that effect. But they do, especially in winter, like to go and sit on the tarmac of runways. Now, yes, lots of the animals will come through and approach the airstrip. It's nice and open. Now, the one thing about tar is that it is slippery. So for the predators, this is actually an ideal hunting ground. The lions of the Kruger National Park have learned to use the tar roads as a hunting technique by chasing the animals towards them. The animals can't get traction on the tar itself and they start to slip. Hello, lions. It's good to see this pride again after all they've been through. Morning, everybody. Hello. Good, thanks. How's it? Okay, perfect. Yeah, perfect. Thank you. Cool. Thanks very much. Cheers, everybody. Enjoy. Oh, here's the question. I suspect that the young male is going to come through to this side. He's probably going to go and rejoin them. I wonder if it's not worth going all the way around the airstrip and back out the other side. Let's settle with this spot for now and just wait and see what they do. I'm also thinking just in terms of getting a little bit closer to the tree line to mitigate the effect of the wind slightly. I'm not sure what it's sounding like on my microphone. I know what it's sounding like in my ears. Okay, bear with me one moment. I'm just going to put my second jacket on. This morning I went out in shorts and a t-shirt. It's changed dramatically. Oh, I nearly whacked the camera. VM's doing the same thing. It's suddenly freezing. Now they're probably on their way towards that buffalo kill. There's a buffalo kill just behind me. Okay, right. I can't drive across the airstrip, it's not allowed, just by the way. Which is an interesting thing, but it is, oh, hold on. Never mind, I think the lion's about to make the decision for us. Perfect. I'm glad that's the decision it's made. I can't believe these are the same lions. It's amazing when time goes past and you don't see them for ages at a time. Then what a difference a couple of months or a year will make in terms of growth. They're actually looking really sturdy. The last time I saw them, they were still running scared as a result of the Birmingham boy takeover. So just to give you a little bit of background for our newer viewers on this lion pride, I'm going to go forward slightly so that we're in line, but without blocking him. Hello, my boys. I'm still nervous a little bit. Okay. Important thing with slightly nervous animals is to just give them plenty of space and let them choose whether or not to approach you. Hello, it's all right. Look at that belly. My goodness gracious. Whatever else has happened in their lives, they are not going hungry. So, of course on Juma, when the Birmingham boys took over from the Matimba males, we were caught up in, is that the one with the injury on his back? I think it is. One of them must have a massive scar somewhere on his hip from the conflict that he came into on Londolozi. So we were caught up in the drama of the takeover between the Birmingham boys and the Matimbas. The Birmingham boys chased the Matimbas south and took over their territory on Juma and Torchwood and so on. And we were very much wrapped up in the chaos that it caused with our lion prides. Oh, we're going to see a nice moment here. He's going to go up and greet his brother, who is where? Now I've lost track. Yeah, he is. He's going to go and greet his brother. That's going to be lovely. Do the head rub. These boys, of course, will form their own coalition one day. The one thing that we then started to learn about or started to experience was actually the knock-on effect that the Matimba's displacement had on the rest of the lions. The Matimbas moved south into Londolozi, into the northern part of Londolozi, and ultimately ended up establishing themselves there. Oh, okay. Fine. Prove me wrong. Your buddy's here. I thought he was going to go up and greet them. Now, the Matimbas were a massive threat to these three young males, and as a result, the tailless lioness, who's not here at the moment, she must be the one with the kill, the tailless lioness actually led them north into Arethusa, and they were running scared. They were terrified. And of course, they had the Birmingham boys. They were stuck between a rock and a hard place. The Birmingham boys on the one side, and they did actually have a narrow escape from the Birmingham boys at least once. And then the Matimba males further to the south. But somehow the tailless lioness has managed to keep the three of them safe through one of the most turbulent times in their young history. And it's impressive to see just how much they've grown. When they first arrived, one of the Salala young males had a massive wound on his hip. And if I remember correctly, it was his back right hip. He was always slightly slower than the other two. Very off to. I think they're on their way to that buffalo kill. Here comes the young lioness. She's on her way as well. They've definitely had a meal last night. They are bulging at the seams, so to speak. Here she goes. Strolling forward. She's also grown since I last saw her. You can see that slightly cautious look across at us. These lions are still young and they have had a very turbulent history. I'm very glad that you're all thrilled to see them. As I said, I am waiting in line to see the Anderson male. Just a reminder that we will be having a school drive in the not too distant future, but I promise you I'm going to do my utmost to get us to that sighting as well. We just have to wait our turn. I'm going to stick with these lions for a little bit. In the meantime, let's head across to Steph, who is back up and running once again.
Well, hopefully not running just yet, even though these buffalo seem to be quite close to us at the moment. I just have to say thank you at this point to Saberia Zumi, who gave us the warning that these two buffalo bulls were heading in our direction while we were walking across quarantine. So just thank you, Saberia, for looking after us like that. It was because of your warning that we looked up and we saw these buffalo on the horizon walking up towards us. Now, what's remarkable about these two buffalo, and I mean, buffalo on foot are definitely something to be remarked upon, because they do pose probably one of our most common threats out here. That and elephant herds at this time of the year are what we're walking into most frequently at the moment. And definitely two old bull buffalo like this would have an association with one another. They'd have a bond with one another, very similar to brothers or to close friends. And just the one on the right-hand side is just a remarkable buffalo. He is just absolutely enormous. While Jandre moves in and zooms in to him, I'm just going to move backwards a little bit. But why I say that that buffalo is remarkable, it's because of that deep horn that you can see. Standing side on to us like he is at the moment, you can see, and there he faces us, just have a look at that boss. Now, by boss, I mean the top part of his horn and the curl of his horn. Have a look at how extraordinarily big that is. It's just a really massive buffalo, that. I'm just having a look at them with my binoculars at the moment as well. And just the deep curl that they have. Now, everybody has different opinions as to what looks good from a buffalo's point of view. What type of horn looks good? For me, I enjoy a very wide set of horns, and the deeper they are curved, the prettier it is for me. So I enjoy that very deep, wide curve. Others enjoy this big boss and then this shallow curve, but I suppose it's all up to your opinion. But at this particular point, I'd like to say hello to the Holy Rosary School in Johannesburg, to the grade 2 class. You are speaking to Steph, and we're on bushwalk, we're on foot. And yes, we do have nothing else around us. It's just us on foot, and you with Jamie as well today. She is bouncing around in a Land Rover all over the property today, and we've got a couple of surprises in store for you over the next couple of minutes. Now, one of the things that we do have for you are those buffalo. Now, I know you may have joined and seen already, but remember, the big five are made up of buffalo, elephant, rhinoceros, lion, and leopard. Alright, all of those things. Buffalo, elephant, rhinoceros, lion, and leopard. And why they're called the Big Five is because they're the five most dangerous animals to approach on foot. And because we're on foot, it's one of the things that we have to look out for when we are walking around over here. We don't have a car around us. We don't have a magic helicopter to call and come pick us up when we're in trouble. We've literally just got our wits. We've got an ash bag, which is this little thing here, which allows me to test wind direction. There we go. And we've got some binoculars. That's all we have at the moment. Oh, we also have a Herbie. There he is over there. He doesn't know we're looking at him. We're going to keep it a bit of a secret at the moment. The wind is blowing, so he can't hear what I'm saying. And he's busy looking for stuff on the ground, obviously. He hasn't got his head up at the moment. Caught him out. Right. And that's all it is. It's just the three of us. And Jandre, of course, who, no matter how much I ask, won't show himself to you. All right. But Jamie has got a surprise for you wherever she is at the moment. We'll catch up with you at the end of this big open area. See you later.
I do indeed have a fantastic surprise for you, but before we go into that, I'd just like to say a very warm welcome to all of you watching at Holy Rosary School. My name is Jamie, behind me sits Viam, and we are right now sitting with an amazing pride of lions called the Salala Pride. Look at this amazing scene in front of us. So Steph was talking about the Big Five. Well, here we go. We have a member of the Big Five, the lions, one female and three young males with very, very round bellies. They've obviously had a massive dinner last night and they're now resting in the shade of the trees. Look at those massive paws. Oh, looking up. There we go. Head is up. Now, these are young males. They are just teenagers. As you can see, they still haven't quite grown their full manes. So they're like teenage boys growing their beards. They are just starting to grow them. They haven't quite filled out. They haven't got a full mane of hair. They've still got lots and lots of growing to do. Bear with me one moment. Somebody's just going to squeeze past to go and have a look at the lions. Now, do remember that because this is happening right here in the middle of the African bush, this means that you can ask us any questions that you would like to about these amazing animals. And lions really are amazing. We're very lucky in what we do in that we get to spend lots and lots of time with them. Now, Isabella, that's a fantastic question that you've started out with. We've been speaking about the drought and the fact that South Africa is in the grips of a terrible drought, which I'm sure you know. Now, you want to know, how has it affected the animals? That's a very good question, because we're actually looking at one of the animals that the drought has actually helped. So for all of our predators out here, the drought's actually been a positive thing for them for now. That's only temporary, but for now, all of the animals that the lions prey upon are forced to walk to water holes which means that the predators just have to hang out around the waterholes and they can catch themselves some dinner. They don't have to go too far to look for them, which is why our lions look so round-bellied. They're so full of food. And that applies across the board to leopards and other predators as well. And because the animals, the prey species like the buffalo and the antelope, aren't as strong as they might otherwise be, it makes them easier for the predators to catch. Now that's the lions and the predators. The herbivores out here have really, really struggled, and it's been difficult to witness. There's been hardly any grass for them to eat, so for animals like buffalo that only really eat grass, they have become very thin and struggling particularly hard to survive. And a few of them have actually died. I'm sorry, everybody, I do have to just hop onto the Game Drive channel. Oh, hold on, my opportunity is gone. I need to just chat to some of the other guides as well. So, very, very good question from you, Isabella, about what the drought, what kind of effect the drought has had. And also, bear in mind, it's not just about the mammal species. We're seeing far less reptiles, far less insect life, and that in turn means that even things like the birds haven't necessarily managed to feed themselves properly, so they haven't managed to raise as many successful chicks. So the drought has a massive, massive knock-on effect with the rest of the animals out here, and it's been tough to watch. Things like to see thin elephants and thin buffalo is a struggle. Sorry, everybody, just standing by. Copy that, thanks very much. Sorry, everybody, I just needed to chat to the other guys because I've actually got so many surprises lined up for you that we might have to leave the lions relatively soon. All kinds of exciting things happening. Now, Mrs. Pistorius, you wanted to know what happened to that lion's tooth. I didn't see. VM, did you see what? Is he missing a canine? Ah, okay. Sorry, Mrs. Pistorius. I'm so busy concentrating on everything around me. I didn't see that. Oh, he's missing a canine. I don't know. Oh, there could be a couple of reasons behind that. It might have been that he was... These young males have actually had a very difficult young life. They were chased around by two different dominant groups of male lions and narrowly escaped death a few times. It's a really tough life being a male lion out here. It could have been that he lost it in a fight, but most likely he lost it while he was hunting. Hunting is a dangerous thing for these animals, particularly hunting buffalo that can weigh up to 900 kilograms and can kick and fight back. And occasionally lions do lose teeth. That being said, you might even find that he had a crack or an infection or something. Now, Kyra Dames, you wanted to know why the lions are breathing so deeply. And the answer is because they're so incredibly full. They've got such full bellies, and all predators will do that. And I'm sorry, we are going to have to leave the lions now. I know we've only just got here, but we'll just finish off with this question. They've got very, very full bellies because all predators will eat as much as they can, as quickly as they can. So that means that the stomach swells up and there's hardly any room for the lion's lungs. So they start to take shorter breaths because they can barely breathe. So they have to pant, and also that much meat production and digesting actually does really produce a huge amount of heat, which for them makes them very, very hot. And lions don't, they can't sweat like we sweat, so they're panting to help to keep themselves cool. I'm sorry to leave the lions so soon. I know it's exciting, but I promise you, you're going to like the surprise that I have in store for you. So while I make my way in that direction, let's head back across to Steph, who has the most amazing information for you.
Thanks, Jamie. I can't quite compete with the lines that you've been on at the moment, except for this. And I think this is very important for you to try at the moment. This is a piece of variable bush willow. A variable bush willow is a type of tree that we have out here. And you can see that something has been eating its bark off. Now, that something is an elephant. Yes, an elephant has broken off this piece of branch and put it in his mouth, like this, and then using his bottom teeth, rolled this piece of wood in his mouth, moving his bottom jaw from side to side to rub off all of this bark, and then when he got to the end here, spat it out on the floor. But what I do want you to do is have a look at this. This is how thick this piece of wood is. Now, it's about as thick as my arm. And so what I want you to do at school is take your hands, put your fingers together like this, and then put them around your leg, here. There. That is about as thick as this. And then stick this branch, as thick as your leg that you've just had now, between your fingers, into his mouth, and then using his teeth, rub off bark that's that thick. Thick as almost as thick as your finger. Isn't that incredible? Hey, elephants are strong, hey? They are also the biggest. All right, we got a bit of a black screen, I heard over there. We're having a bit of an issue with our backpack today. It's what happens when you come live from the middle of the Kruger National Park, like we are at the moment. And every now and again, we have these, what we call little glitches or gremlins. And these gremlins seem to be eating our picture from time to time, and it goes black. So don't get too scared if it happens again. It's been happening the whole morning. We're used to it, and on top of it as well. Isn't that incredible though, eh? How strong that elephant is? Can come up to a tree like this, break it, this is what he did over here, break it, and probably used his tusk. Put his tusk in there, and then his trunk over the top, and then bang, and snapped it off, and then just shoveled it into his mouth. And they'll do that for about 200 kilograms a day. So a big male elephant, someone that was strong enough to break this particular branch off, eats 200 kilograms a day. Now, 200 kilograms, what I want you to do is ask your teacher how much you weigh on average. Probably now in grade 2, how old are you now? 9 or 10, you're probably weighing about 30 kilograms, maybe 35 kilograms, I would imagine. So 30 kilograms, that would mean that eight of you together is what an elephant eats every single day. Isn't that incredible? 6 to 8 of you every single day is what an elephant has to eat to stay healthy. Definitely won't fit in your lunchbox, hey? I don't think so, no. Won't fit in your lunchbox. Won't fit in mine either. Let's carry on with this walk. We see in a day, and that's actually a very, very good question, because there are different places in Africa where your chances of seeing more animals or less animals happen. Now, in an area park, there are on average 10 head of animals, 10 animals per hectare. So a hectare is two of your soccer fields put next to each other. Two soccer fields next to each other in the Kruger National Park, the average is 10 animals per hectare. That's what the average is in the Kruger National Park. In other places in Africa, like East Africa, the Serengeti or the Masai Mara, in a place like, well, the Ngorongoro Crater, for lack of a better description, have up to 100 animals in the same two soccer fields. 100 animals, so 10 times the amount of animals that we have in the Kruger National Park. So that's to answer your question broadly. How many animals do I see on a day though? We don't get very far. We walk anywhere from about 3 to about 10 miles a walk. And on that, if we see about, I don't know, Jandre, what do we see a lot of? If we see a lot of impala, or a lot of buffalo, or a lot of elephant, we can see up to 50 animals in a walk. But generally, we only see between 5 and 10 animals on a walk, if we're lucky. of course, with the way that we walk through this bush, and Jandre's got a backpack on that looks a little bit like mine, only about double the size and with a huge aerial at the top, we sometimes make a bit of noise while we're walking through the bush, and that can scare the animals away. Don't forget, they've got big ears and big eyes and can smell very, very good. Nokia, good morning, Nokia. You've just asked me, do animals cry if they get hurt? Ooh, that's a good question. How am I going to answer that? Yes, they do cry, but they don't cry tears like we cry. I would imagine that they get sore. Everyone feels pain. And when you feel pain, it depends on the level of pain that you feel. You'll do different things. It'll change your normal behavior. For you and me, we have tears that run down our face and we cry and we make a big noise. And that's because we're creating attention. We're drawing attention to ourselves. We want our mommies and daddies to come up and give us a plaster and hold us nice and tight. And it's because we are a social group of animals. For things like lion and leopard, they don't cry, they don't make a lot of noise because they don't want to draw attention to themselves. But depending on how sore they are, they might retract, they might go and hide. And it's not uncommon to find animals that are very sore lying up underneath bushes just like this. And they will lie there and they will get better. Now, they don't have people that feed them. Of course, we're in the Kruger National Park. We don't help animals that are, well, we don't help most animals. I'm not going to say we don't help animals. We do, of course, help animals. That's what vets do. But generally speaking, we won't help an animal that can help itself. And animals will come and lie up in the shade, hidden away, and they will get better. They'll wait for Mother Nature to help and their bodies to help mend one another. But they don't cry like we do. We only cry because we are social species, and social species like to be held and comforted. And so no. I hope that answered your question. A yes and no question. All right, now I was going to climb that tree, but I see it's a little bit beyond me at the moment. That is a marula tree. But because of that, and because Jamie has finally arrived, I think, at her surprise for you, we're going to send you over to Jamie and we'll catch up with you in a little bit.
I'm still trying to find your surprise. I don't know exactly where it is, but I'm hoping it's somewhere along this road. Oh, it is a very special surprise, and it's actually the first time that I've seen this particular surprise. So bear with me, because I'm just going to try and concentrate on searching for him. We're almost at the end of the road, which is making me slightly nervous that I've missed something somewhere along the line. Let's keep checking carefully. You can help me look, actually. I'm not going to tell you what we're looking for, though. But let's see if we can all look together. Aha! I think I've spotted your surprise. I hope you're all very, very excited. Now, with this particular animal, it's really very shy. So we're going to have to be nice and quiet as we go in. We keep our voices down and whisper. Let's go in and see where your surprise is. I can see some people there. Some of the other people at, perhaps some of you have managed to go to Kruger, or perhaps you've even been to the Sabi Sands. So you might even have seen this animal before, but you might have been on a real live safari. So there are people here. There are guests that come and see these animals. Oh, Brooke, you wanted to know if we ever have to save any animals and how do we do it? Brooke, the answer to that is yes, occasionally we have had to. I've had to as well. Now, it depends. It's a difficult one. So we can't save an animal in a situation where it's part of nature. So let's say we see the lions hunting buffalo. We can't interfere there and save the buffalo because that's nature. That's how it works. And the same thing, actually, if an animal gets sick with a natural disease or something similar. But if an animal has been hurt by a human being in a horrible case, let's say perhaps it's been caught in a bushmeat snare, maybe something else has happened to it, then absolutely we will save them. What we do is we call in a vet, and often the vets need our help to try and find the animal again. And the vet will come in with a very special dart gun that he uses to shoot anesthetic into the animal so that the animal goes to sleep, and we are able to go then go and treat it. Now, it can be quite dangerous. Sometimes the animal doesn't go quite to sleep. If they're hurt, then they might be afraid. I can see the animal. Hold on, I'm going to show you your surprise. One of my favorite animals, and I'm sure many of you enjoy them as well. Look at that. A magnificent male leopard. This is the first time I've ever seen this particular leopard. And isn't he magnificent? He is rumored to be one of the biggest leopards that is currently in this area. In fact, in the whole of the Sabi Sand, it's thought that he is the biggest leopard here. His name is Anderson, and he is massive. So going back to treating the animal, we will dart it and then treat it. The vet will treat it. Now, Jenny, you wanted to know if any animals will eat their own kids. And no, very, very seldom. So what will happen is only in a situation where a female is absolutely desperate, if she's starving, there's a chance that she might eat her own babies, particularly with predators. But that hardly ever happens out here. But a big male leopard can be a serious threat to young leopard cubs. If he hasn't mated with a female, with the mother of the cubs, then he's not sure whether or not those cubs are his, and therefore he will kill her to be able to mate with her and to produce his own cubs. The same goes for lions as well, which is why those young Solana males that we saw earlier, the young male lions, that's why they've had such a hard life as well. Because they're just young enough that they would have been in trouble if a male coalition had come in. So male lions often kill cubs that are not their own. So whilst it's not a case of the animal killing their babies, it does happen that, for example, a leopard will kill leopard cubs and a lion will kill lion cubs. Isabella, you wanted to know why did I want to become a game ranger? And I personally think I have one of the best jobs in the world to be able to look at incredible creatures like this. Isabella, I actually always wanted to become a vet, but I'm really, really allergic to animals. So that was something that I decided when I was 18 that I couldn't do. I look back on it now and I think maybe I could have done it and that I just got scared. But I did manage to get the next best thing in terms of being able to spend time out here in the bush. So when I was 8, I went on a trip to the rhino camp in Lapalali, and I got to hand feed a black rhino that they had rescued, and I got to go on walks with rhino. And from the earliest age, from when I was, I don't know, maybe 6 or 7, I've always felt happiest when I'm out here in the bush. It's like I'm more myself in this particular place than I am anywhere else. I'm happiest here, I feel most peaceful here, and I always knew I wanted to work out here, and that's how it worked. And Jamie, hey, we share the same name. Jamie watches Animal Planet, and I'm so glad you're on board with us, Jamie. You watch Animal Planet and want to know why leopards hide in trees. So, although this is a massive leopard, he is still one of the smallest predators out here. A lion is much, much bigger, and even a hyena is probably about equal size. So leopards hide in trees because they are the best climbers, and it means that they can escape from other predators, because other predators will often aim to either steal a leopard's food or, in the case of a lion, actually try and catch and kill them so that there's less competition. So what a leopard will do, what a leopard is really good at doing, is actually grabbing its food that it's caught, a kill, and taking it up into a tree. Now, Anderson actually has a kill here, but before we look too closely, we're not going to go too close in, but he's got a warthog carcass up in the top of the tree. So we're just going to have a brief look at that. That's his food. It's basically like he's put it in a pantry, and now it's out of the way of any scavengers that might come through, because nothing can climb as well as a leopard can climb. Lions can climb a little bit, but not nearly as well as a leopard. So what he's done a very clever, clever thing. He's moved his food off the ground, and now he knows he can sleep peacefully without anything coming to steal it from him. And don't forget, just talking about hyenas, don't forget that just because they do feed off, or they do scavenge, doesn't mean that they don't hunt, and they don't deserve that horrible reputation they have. They're actually amazing animals. We're going to sit here with this incredible male leopard for now. Let's jump on board with Steph and see what he's up to on his walk.
Now, you know, with us being on foot over here, as you can see, lying down on the sand, you're obviously asking, what am I scared of? And one of the things that I'm scared of most out here is a mommy lioness and her cubs, or a mommy leopard and her cubs. And we've got some very fresh tracks here of a lioness with her babies. And I want to try and show you them. This is mommy's track. Here it is here. That's a mommy lion track. They've got four toes. One toe, two, three, and four. And then there is the back of the pad. So if you open up your hand, what we're looking at is the tips of the fingers. One, two, three, four, and then the back of the pad here. Now, where I have two lobes on the back of my pad, if I had to put my hand down in the sand, I have two lobes. A lion has three. All right, and this is her baby's track right here. That is a baby lion track. Isn't that amazing? So we've got mom here, and we've got baby here. And now I need to stand up so that I can make sure that they're not hunting me. But anyway, we're gonna send you back over to that lovely male leopard with Jamie.
We're still with this amazing male leopard, and look how full he is. He's had a really good breakfast, just like the lions we were with earlier. And you can see, remember what we were talking about? You were asking about why the lions were breathing like that. See that Anderson is breathing like that as well. He is also panting. That's generally what you see when predators have had a big meal. Now, Montana, you wanted to know why do I say, wow, look at those teeth. You wanted to say why I said that leopards are so shy. Now, leopards are an interesting animal. They have learned that the thing that makes them so successful is that they have learned to be secret and solitary, and they like to hide in dense vegetation. A leopard, often you can walk right past a leopard and it will stay hidden. It won't get aggressive or try and run away. It just relies on its camouflage. That's why leopards can be very, very shy. Now, Anderson, apparently, despite his enormous size, is actually quite shy, which is why we're very careful to give him plenty of space. But this morning, for example, Montana, because leopards can get used to people, this morning I walked right next to a leopard called Karula, and she was fine. Newsy, you wanted to know, oh, he's up. Wait, I think he's just lying down again. You wanted to know why leopards' ears move. So actually, once upon a time, human beings could move their ears as well, and all of the animals do it. If you ever go, perhaps you have pet dogs or cats, or maybe you have friends with pet dogs or cats, look at the way that their ears function. So the ears are built to amplify the sound, so they make every sound bigger and direct it into the inner ear itself. And what that means is that he can move his ears around to choose which direction he's listening in, making sure that he can listen in every possible sound. So one ear might be listening in front of him, and the other ear might be turned back towards us and listening towards us. That's why leopards can move their ears. And you'll see it in all mammal species, or most mammal species. They can actually move their ears around. Now, he has been moving his ears quite a lot today, and that's because it's really, really windy. which means that all of the leaves and the sticks blowing around, he has to listen to and make sure that it's not an animal coming to sneak up on him. Okay, we've only got a few short minutes and he's turned his back on us, so come, let's reposition and get a slightly different view before we have to say goodbye to you all. I'm so excited. This is the first time I've seen this leopard and it's always very, very exciting getting to know different ones. Anastasia, you want to know if we send any animals to the zoo? And no, we don't. We don't send any animals to the zoo. There's no need to take our wild animals out of the wild here. The zoos have enough access to breeding programs and other animals from other zoos. They don't need to take any wild animals from here. And don't you think that's right? Don't you think that an animal that lives here in the wild, that enjoys all of the freedom of the wild, don't you think it deserves to stay here? I think so. Well, unfortunately, it is time for me to say goodbye to you all. So we're leaving you with this one last view of the leopard. So a big thank you to all of the Safari Live team involved, to the school for joining us. I hope you had a wonderful time. Enjoy the rest of your school day. And to all of our regular viewers, I'm so glad that we managed to get Anderson on camera. I hope you've had a marvelous sunrise safari, and we will catch up with you this afternoon. For now though, goodbye and enjoy your day and this view of the spectacular Anderson male.